Thomas Show. Sirius 108 and XM 139.
This is the Jay Thomas Show.
The interesting, the odd, and the bizarre people behind the,
interesting.
The odd and bizarre stories. Jay gets in it, stirs it up, and spits it out. He's a professional. It's all here on the Jay Thomas Show with Rodney Lee Conover, Julie Madison, Kevin Meaney, Garrett and Christina, and Ira the Weatherman. This is the Jay Thomas Show.
All right, Christina and Garrett are back there. Don't forget 888-4102-102. Oh, my God. Remember remember that movie I did that never came out?
Sex Tax?
No, that's
Pool
one
Boy?
Of the ones. That one. Rodney just sent me an email that the producer just filed for bankruptcy. God. He used to, his office used to be in his car, you know. That's always a bad sign, you know. Cigars, he had, he had the computer in there, and he had the fax machine, you know, he had it all, you know. And he'd put the seat back, and he'd take naps. Then the phone would ring, and it was a nice car. It was like, you know, like a really, you know, one of those big BMW, you know, sedans. But his whole life was there. And in the back seat, his clothes were all laid out really nicely. It was kind of an interesting thing. You wonder where he peed and where he showered, you know.
Wasn't that an American Pie movie?
Yeah, you know, maybe his... I'll have to check this out. I don't know. I won't say his name. But, well, apparently it's bye-bye, Miss American Pie. People always love sending me... But he might have taken a company bankrupt or something like that. I think you're a good businessman if you do that. You ever notice that one?
Yeah.
Donald Trump is always bankrupt, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'd be mortified if I was bankrupt, you know. anybody. By the way, we got a bunch of emails. We said we're going to play this 911 call about the golf pro, this young golf pro, who apparently was befriended by a doctor who gave her prescriptions for her depression or whatever. And according to the report, you know what, Garrett, why don't you look again? He has not been arrested, and I don't know if he is a person of interest, but she reportedly put a bag on her feet and then a bag on her head and sat there until she was dead. And of course, a lot of people said that sounds like urban myth. No, she was probably took bunches of drugs also at the same time, I'm guessing. But she basically anesthetized herself so that she would pass out and then tightened the bag around her neck so that when she gasped for air, she was so out of it she couldn't pull the bag off of her head, you know. I do always get a lot of people say stuff to me like, well, you know, the way you feel about the homeless and the suicide and all that, it makes us feel that you would be very uncaring if someone in your family or someone you knew, you know, were to, you know, for this to happen to. And I'm not uncaring. The weird thing is, I think we're all depressed. I really mean it. I think I am depressed 24 hours a day. But I've never said that to anybody. I wouldn't wake up in the morning and turn to my wife and go, oh, God. Oh, man. I'm depressed. And if my wife turned to me and said that, I would think, oh, fuck, my day is done. Okay? I think that when you say it, then it's true. Okay? Up until that point, we had the authors of that best-selling book, Faking It, right? Remember that Faking It book? And the premise was, you know, keep faking that you're happy or faking you like your job or whatever or fake it in your relationship or whatever. And believe it or not, at some point, either you'll know you're faking it or you'll be okay with it and you will move on, right? So that's how I feel. But I've known so many people. I mean, relatives, not my relatives. My mother, you know, it's wasn't allowed. No matter what's happened to my brother and everything else, I mean, at the end of the day, as long as he has gas for his boat and bait, I mean, this is the truth. My mother was having open heart surgery. We had no insurance because she refused to tell the United States government her age. Think about that for a second. She would not tell the United States. When she hit 65, when you're supposed to get Social Security, whatever, she would not fill out the paperwork, right? So, and of course the, you know, the nut doesn't fall far from the tree. I'm the same way. I do not like telling anybody, you know, my age and all. So finally she has a heart attack at a dance and, they misread, the heart monitor, the EKG. They try to call her for 2 or 3 days saying, you know, we misread it. You've had a heart attack. She'd put the phone off the hook. My brother was completely wild. I think he owned a strip club and he was, you know, flying drugs all over the world and everything else. And so in and out of the house. And finally they put the phone back on, you know, and there was all these messages and they bring my mother and they have the open heart surgery. So I go into the hospital and it's going to cost like $100,000, this surgery. And then I find out my mother hadn't told the United States government her age. So we didn't have Medicare. So I'm trying to do all of that. Meanwhile, my brother is chased by the police in an unregistered owner to be determined at a later date Porsche. Being chased, he is arrested because they caught him hiding in a, you know, like he pulled in somewhere, like and hid in a garage or something, or in a carport or whatever. And so he disappears for 3 days, and I can't find him. So I go through all of this stuff, you know. Finally, I find my brother, and he says, well, you know, this happened, that. We go in, my mother's having open heart surgery, my aunts are all crying and everything else. I'm yelling at my brother, got it all straightened out. I mean yelling, working him over, yelling and screaming. And they say, you can only be here for 10 minutes when you have the open heart surgery. You got to go back home. We go back home, screaming and yelling. And it gets quiet. My brother goes, hey, you know, let's go fishing. So he said. I said, what are you, nuts? He goes, well, what do you want to do? He said, you've been yelling for the last 3 days and, you know, we can't go visit her. So let's get in the boat and let's go fishing. So we got in the boat and, you know, we smoked a joint. We drank. I think we probably did some coke, right? And we went fishing. And I'll tell you something. There is really something to be said for that kind of, like, you know, the way you, you know, get over stuff. His daughter called me yesterday and said, you know, Dad cried the last time I was at the house. I said, really? What do you think that meant? I think it meant he wanted money. That's what she said to me. I said, yeah, that might have been it. I mean, so I lived in this family where your emotions were used to get something, right? But we're all depressed, and it's all terrible. So to get back to it, if you're going to kill yourself or jump off a bridge or put a bag over your head or whatever, I don't know why I don't. I just don't feel sorry for you. I'll sit with you, and I'll try and get you to snap out of it. And if you're an alcoholic or a drug addict, I mean, I will try. But most of my friends that are alcoholics and drug addicts, I only stay with them, hang around with them, until they get to that point that they're no fun anymore. I don't hang with them when they're no fun. So it may be 20 minutes sometimes. And I have a few of these guys that I hang with. It may be a day or two or an hour or whatever. But once they're no fun, I go home. Once my enjoyment is tarnished, that's when I leave the arena. That's it. And, well, is that selfish? I guess it is, but it sure is comforting, you know. And so then you get back home, and all that shit's happening back at your house. And I just learned over the years that, you know, people make these crazy, crazy decisions, and they decide that they're nuts or something. And I we work with Madison. She is positive that there is something wrong with her. I'm going to tell you now, there is absolutely nothing wrong with that woman. There is no chemical thing wrong with her. There is nothing wrong. She just decided, in my estimation, now I could be wrong, that she wants, don't you agree with that, Garrett? She just decided to be nutty?
Yeah, completely.
Yeah, completely. So she'll cry and get upset and why, you know, And then there are these, have you seen these commercials where the people are really depressed and they take a pill and they feel better? How would you like to be, have you ever been around a person who takes a pill to feel better? There is a local guy here in town. He's on life support now and no one gives a shit because he was an asshole. But he was a drunk too. And he would kill you playing golf while he was drunk, completely drunk, talking to himself, and would shoot under par every time. A fantastic golfer. His wife, I think, was on lithium. Have you ever met anybody on lithium?
No.
They smile. There's a frozen smile on their faces all the time. It is the oddest thing. And so he's a nut. No fun to be around. She should have left him. And you turn to her and it's, hi. How are you? And she'll say something like, are your boys enjoying school? And her husband's like under the table, crawling around barking like a dog, right? It's like when I go to the gym and these anorexic women are working out. I saw one this morning, a new one, completely anorexic. I mean, little tiny skinny legs on the elliptical. And not going fast, just like kind of walking. And I'm thinking, honey, you don't need to be at the gym. You need to be at the Burger King. You need to be having a malt. You need to be having a Whopper. Let me cook for you. Let me fatten your ass up, you know? So when I see that kind of insanity and they can't stop being nuts, I go right to the survival of the fittest. I think too many of us who are too weak to be here live. I just think, and if I get weak, I'm going to die. I'm going to be very sad, but I'm going to die. Once I get weak, and if I get mentally weak, oh Jesus, you know, like, forget Alzheimer's. I mean it. Bullet to the head. See you later. I read an article today. It shows this guy was in really good shape. You know, in his 50s or whatever, and it shows his wife, and they're on these two exercise bikes. And it says, Joyce Johnson believes that changing her family's diet and exercising more with her husband, Ben, may stop the movement of his Alzheimer's. So I'm looking at this picture. So Ben's been diagnosed with Alzheimer's. So she's got him on the treadmill. Now he's not gone yet. And she's changing his diet. And I'm sitting there going, honey, make sure Ben can still pull the trigger because it's over. When my mom was put in that Alzheimer's unit, you know, she was, you know, 90 years old, 88 years old, whatever. There were a couple of guys there in their 50s. Who are going to live maybe another 30 or 40 years stumbling around the goddamn Alzheimer's unit. I want to tell you, how about this? A crossbow, whatever it is, you know, or you ought to hire somebody. It ought to be in your insurance policy that you're allowed to hire somebody to off you. Now, Kevorkian would be the guy. By the way, you got to see that show, by the way, that Al Pacino won the Emmy for the other night. Mm-hmm. You know, Kevorkian's like a nut, but, you know, it was some small percentage of people that he accepted to help them commit suicide. Did you know that? It was like very few people. And they would be all twisted with, you know, either MS or whatever. Was there a depressed woman? I don't think, the only thing she was depressed about was constant pain, you know. He helped some people put themselves to sleep when they had constant pain. That's what he did, you know. But so I know it sounds like I'm joking. And the homeless, 94% of the homeless are single males. The kids and women that have been abused and all of that kind of stuff, absolutely help them. There should not be any kids in the street. Take them away from the parents. If you see them walking down the fucking street with a stroller, with two homeless kids in the stroller, and the homeless asshole, you know, collecting bottles and cans and all that. 94% of the homeless are these guys, and some huge portion of them, maybe as much as 90%, are alcoholics and drug addicts and everything else, and they will probably never, ever, ever do anything for us, ever. So I don't give a shit about them. That's it. I'm sorry. I just don't. I mean, clean them up, bathe them, you know. And so, look, you got like, I'll give you a year. But at this time next year, if you're still in this shape, you go right over into the homeless van over there. You go right to the homeless van. Because what do you want to live for? Do you know they took 50 people in L.A. and they took them off the streets? They did not try to cure them. They just wanted them to live in an apartment, not a shelter, not where people rob you. 50 of them. And it's controversial. It just ended, this program. And it's very, and you can read about it. I think if you go online, I don't know what you type in. It would be the 50 homeless. There was some 50-50 or something like that. Some large portion of these people would not stay in the apartment. They would sleep on the street laying on cardboard out near a beer bottle or what. I mean, it was crazy. You and I go, oh, they're so uncomfortable. Apparently, this group of people, some of them don't care. I don't know. They had trouble. I think they only really saved about four or five of them. And this woman that ran the program after 5 or 6 years finally had to quit because of exhaustion. She was so exhausted with trying to help these. But and what she decided to do was not cure them. Just get them, you know, into the apartment. They couldn't bring any booze or drugs into the apartment. But you know what? She might have done like a don't ask, don't tell, you know, a kind of a deal. There was also a guy recently who was run over by a trash truck. I think I mentioned this, Garrett, but I'll mention it again. He was a homeless guy, and his legs were run over by a trash truck. He was in the by the dumpster, but he was under the dumpster, and the truck came and rolled over his legs. A lawyer got him, I think, $700,000. So the lawyer took, you know, his one-third, and the guy ended up. And remember, there's no taxes on a settlement. You don't pay taxes on an insurance or a, you know, like a cop, you know, beat you up kind of a settlement. They found the guy dead recently. He had bought more. Give me a beer, Garrett. Some sort of crazy beer, like big giant 40-ounce something of beer, something.
Old English?
They found him dead behind 20 bottles of Old English ale or whatever it is, laying dead. And the lawyer said, you know, I was afraid this would happen to Bill. That's what he said. I was afraid. He got $500,000. And he just, you know, he drank himself to death, you know. And I think he had a bow tie on when he was dead. You know, something weird. Like he bought like a coat and a tie and was dead. So that's it. But when you're a professional athlete and you want to kill yourself and all that, didn't Terrell Owens try? Am I wrong about that? Did Terrell Owens try and kill himself?
There was an alleged thing, yeah.
Yeah.
Where he took too many pills or something.
You know, there is also this thing where I am owed something. The world, you, somebody owes me something. So all of us feel that we have not accomplished what we're supposed to. Then you pick up the newspaper and you see Paris Hilton or you see Robin Williams or you see some rich guy or you see this little asshole that owns Facebook and all. Did they work hard for what they got? Yeah, I'm sure they did. Even Paris Hilton. But you know what? I can't stand them because they got more than I got. And so I look at that and I think, well, shit, I worked hard too. And you probably go, yeah, well, I worked hard too. We don't have anything like that. You probably listen to me and go, well, you're a prick and you got more than that's fine. That's what I'm here for. You're right. And I don't lift anything heavy. I don't have to sweat. I don't drive a truck. I don't do a fucking thing. Nothing. And yet I have a lot more than people that really work hard. Okay. And so I think that jealousy and that anger at that is absolutely not just normal. I think it's necessary. If I didn't wake up every day wishing ill on others, I would not have a good day. I could not walk around going, oh, look at all the people that are doing better than me. I hope they continue doing better. No. If a plane went down with every 5'8" curly-haired 50 to 60-year-old actor in America, I couldn't get on the phone with my agent fast enough. I just heard everybody that looks like me is dead. I would be on the phone in five. Jay, isn't it terrible? Every actor, every medium-grade actor died in a plane crash. Really? Can you set me up with some appointments this afternoon? I wouldn't go to a funeral. I would be too busy with my meetings. They're gone. They're out of my way. Now, Garrett, is that a bad person? Does that make me a bad person?
Maybe in the eyes of some people, but I don't see it that way.
You're just as evil as I am, aren't you?
I am.
If everybody 6'2" with one of those little bebop beards with too much saliva in their mouth died, if you read that in the paper, what would you do?
They're all probably dead. Be scared that they're coming for me next.
Oh, you know, see, that's how depressed you are. What I would do is I would hug you and I'd go, we're in now, Garrett, we're in. You're the last 6'3", you know, saliva mouth left. And I'm the last, you know, 5'7½, curly-haired old actor. It's, Garrett, we're in. All of a sudden, the trainer, bam, kills his bone.
Buddy cop movie, here we come.
That's exactly right. I'd be going, hey, by the way, thanks for the job. I have a friend who's 6'3", and the agent goes,
nothing else, too much, so what?
He does. He has too much.
Oh, my God.
What do you think?
Buddy movie.
That's right. Todd, it's Albany, New York. Hi, Jay Thomas. Hello, Todd. How are you?
I'm pretty good, Jay.
Yes, sir.
Don't you think that evolution is messed up by all the medicines everyone is on? So, like, yeah, most people should have died. The rest of us should live because we're the fittest.
Yeah, you know, but the weird thing is, you know, we got some cats at the house, right? And the little girl cat who would have been killed outside and not eaten or whatever, you know, we took her in, we fed her, you know, we're crazy. But I can see that she wouldn't have made it, you know. The two big guy cats would have eaten everything, and that would have, and you know, and she'd have had a bunch of little kittens and been dead. So I don't know what to think of all that, but I believe that the crust of the earth, the covering that we have now, I don't think there's any way that we can stop, even if we, if we really did all the, you know, stop birth rate and all that. At some point, it's like that petri dish that's filled with the bacteria. It's pretty much over, you know.
Yeah, oh, I know. Well, what about all of us smart people out here who would be the fittest? We can't have kids because we're out working too hard.
Well, the reason why you have to keep having kids is who's going to take care of your social security in the future? Remember, you need workers so that we can retire. So we need more people to be born in the United States. That's the truth. We've actually gotten to the point now where we're kind of screwed up. Our kids have to work, I think, 25 years to make sure that you and I go to our grave happy.
And we need that.
We do. Hey, you know, I also think there's a time when you should say to your kids, don't have any children. It doesn't look good. The future doesn't look good. Enjoy yourself, but don't have any kids. Yeah, that's the odd one. And I think we ought to let every gay person marry. How many times can they procreate, for Christ's sakes? You never see a gay couple having 9 kids like the Duggars. What are those idiots? The 19, 20 children, you know, Duggars?
Yeah, what's that one? I don't know their name, but
you never see a gay couple having more kids than they can handle, you know? You know, well, first of all, a gay woman has so much testosterone in her, any guy would have like exactly 1 kid and go, I am never doing that again. So the testosterone says to the gay woman's vagina, let's not do this again.
But the man in that kid would be.
Think of the what? The football player the kid will be.
The football player you would make with all that testosterone.
Oh, you know what? I've actually coached two or three kids who had not gay dads, but gay moms. And these kids were tougher nails and very big. You are correct. Because they had the male, the sperm, and then they had the gay mother's testosterone. You're exactly correct. I never thought about that. And the two big, you know, dyke mothers in the stands. Come on, Jimmy. Jimmy. You know? And you always make the child of a gay couple a linebacker, Garrett.
Yeah.
All right? Remember that. Because you know how linebackers have to have that anger?
Mm.
You know? Linebackers like to creep up on the quarterback and then just knock the shit out of him. Defenseless. Completely defenseless. You know? All right. Thank you, Todd of Albany.
You're welcome.
I mean, give me a break. You're standing there, a guy like me, standing there, looking around, you know, and you run as fast as you can into my back. I mean, come on. That's where's the sport in that, actually, okay? And they go, oh, what a great linebacker he was, you know. And the linebacker also plays in that position where if he wants to get in a tussle, he can. But if he doesn't, he doesn't have to, right or wrong. He's like kind of in the back, and if you know, a linebacker, when a guy goes to block him, can back up. Whoa, whoa, can back up, you know, and you fall down, then he hops over you. A lot of linebackers hop over people. You know, the defensive line, the defensive ends, they're battling people, right? Then all the little gay defensive backs, the little fruits in the backfield, way in the back, right? You know, who back up really slow. I love them. Watch them when you watch football. They back up really slow. They back up like dancers, you know, little slow dancers like that. You know, yeah, those are the fruity guys. Every time a gay guy comes out in football, it's either a defensive back or a quarterback. You ever notice that? It's never a tackle.
Never.
No. You know why? Tackles can't pet you. Their hands are too rough.
Like Lenny from Mice and Men?
Oh, but I just want to kiss the puppy. I want to kiss the... Lenny, give me the puppy. I want to kiss the puppy. Lenny, oh! Puppy asleep.
But he had that mouse, right? Forever.
My mouse. He kept the mouse, but he killed the puppy.
I think that's how it went.
Then, what, did he kill a woman? Grab the woman real hard?
I read it so long ago, but yeah.
And then his buddy had to kill him, right? His friend had to kill him. Have you seen the movie In Bruges?
Is that the one where they talk funny the whole time? Colin Farrell?
No, the movie's fantastic. I saw it last night. My kids have seen it. I went on, you know, on demand, and it was fantastic. I mean, really great. You'll love it.
I saw it, and they talked with an accent, and I didn't understand it.
It's from England.
But it's one of those, like,
no
special... Northern England or something.
No, they're from Ireland, but no, I understood every word. There is a movie like that. It's not In Bruges. In Bruges, you can understand. In Bruges is a commercial movie, and there's an American midget in it, but it's not the famous midget. Who's the famous dwarf that's kind of handsome? He's in The Last Station and Death at a Funeral and...
Tom Cruise?
No. He's anyway. I don't know what his name is, but there's a dwarf in it, and I guess they all look alike because I thought it was him, but it's not. And the dwarf is in it, which is always a laugh riot when the dwarf is in it. You'll love this movie: prostitution, drugs, guns.
Is it
one time
Peter Dinklage?
Peter Dinklage. By the way. If you're going to be a midget, your last name ought to be Dinklage. I mean, hey, Jay, what do you call your penis? My Dinklage. Okay. Now, what do you call that little tiny tool that you use to when your glasses break? You know, that little tool you use to put the little tiny screw in? That's called a Dinklage. Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm. When you... when you operate on somebody's veins,
yes,
and you get the little tiny vein, what do you stick in there? Oh, a Dinklage rod. It means little, tiny. Larry, Michigan. Hello, Larry. How are you?
Good, Jay. How are you doing?
Good. I'm responding to a lot of emails that I received about me making fun of people that have died. And I don't know, a couple of days there, it seemed like there were a lot of deaths or whatever. And then I guess people just had enough of it. But the worst one apparently is when I was not sorry that the woman put the bag on her head and on her feet and took the pills and died. And so that's why the last 30 minutes have been a bit of an apology, but also an explanation of it. All right.
I don't think you got to apologize for it. I mean, that's where humor comes from, you know, from pain and sorrow. So come on.
That's where he, wait a minute. Now, hold it a second. I have never, ever, hold it. I've never even sat down and tried to think where humor comes from. You say it comes from pain and sorrow.
Absolutely.
Hmm.
All humor comes from somebody else's pain.
Well, you know what? Yeah, you know what? I'll tell you something. I'm able to dispense painful humor. So what I'll do is I will bring the pain to you, and you'll, everyone will be laughing and you'll feel embarrassed. Now that's happened a couple of times even in this week. But the best one, there's this gorgeous girl that works in this neighborhood. She is gorgeous. She is like a model, and she dresses in these beautiful clothes. And I don't know, she must work in a law office or something, and I'm walking to work and she's always getting a cup of coffee or whatever, but she's not nice. She doesn't look at anybody. She doesn't say hello. She looks like Elin Norger, you know, Tiger Woods' ex-wife, Elin Norger. So I have said hello to her a few times, whatever. The other day, I see this in, she's beautiful, standing by the mailbox right up the street, and she has this bulldog with her. You know those really ugly, they're big, they have a head like J. Edgar Hoover or like Churchill. You know those big, ugly?
Sure.
That's a bulldog. English bulldog.
Yeah. Absolutely.
I walk across the street, and she basically gets in front of me and shoves her mail into the slot right as I'm reaching for it. And I turn to her and I said, you know what? I don't know who's uglier, you or that fucking dog. Now, she is gorgeous, but do you know for that moment she thought she was ugly? And her face dropped. It was the greatest thing I've done in months, okay? And she will not forget the day that a guy walked up to her and told her she was as ugly as his English bulldog.
Now that's a good insult, but for humor, for comedy, the comedy would be for this you know, arrogant slut, beautiful slut to be walking along and slip on her own bulldog's shit and fall flat on her ass.
Here's where the comedy comes in. But here's where the comedy comes in. If we had seen that, we would have both laughed. But if you'd have been with me and I'd have said, the only thing uglier than you is that dog, you would have laughed. I just didn't have the audience there.
Well, of course, yeah.
Yeah, it was a private laugh, you know? You know what would have happened if she would have turned to me and I realized that she's not mean, she's a deaf mute, and she'd have gone, what did you say?
And once again, see?
I'm sorry, I can't hear. Oh, God.
See? That's why all comedy turns on somebody else's pain.
Garrett, she would have turned to me and gone, I'm sorry, what did you say? And they go, Jay, did you know that beautiful girl is deaf? Oh, my God. And that's her hearing bulldog? What? The bulldog hears for her? You know. All right. Larry, thank you very much. Thank you.
You bet, Jay. Thank you.
Jeff of Charleston, South Carolina, which I like to call the Santa Barbara of the South. That's one of my favorite cities, Charleston, South Carolina. Man.
It's a beautiful place.
You're lucky to live there. Really, that's another spot in that whole area. Great place to live like you're on vacation. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a nice place to be. I thoroughly enjoy it. I've been here about 30 years, so it's pretty good.
Fabulous.
Hey, the other day, you were trying to figure out what was the origin of when the conversation turned sour about when you made a comment about somebody dying. If I'm not mistaken, it was when you were talking to Eddie Izzard, and he made mention of somehow his mother dying, and you immediately said, oh, did any of her dresses fit? And there was
Now, wait a second. I am such a fan of Eddie Izzard's. And I was so excited that he said he would come on. And I spoke to JT, my oldest son. And when he and I saw Eddie Izzard at the Aspen Comedy Festival, we said, this is the greatest comic we've ever seen. He is magnificent. But this guy was a prick. This guy was, I don't know what he was doing, but he was going to run for parliament and he was very serious and all. And yeah, I thought he'd have a statement about that or something. But boy, you're right. He didn't like that.
Yeah, I've seen him on Letterman, and he's really fun and silly when they're talking about fun stuff. But the minute anything comes along or gets too silly, he just tightens up and loses a sense of humor. And I think it was kind of a similar thing when you made that funny crack with him. That just sort of split him in half somehow.
Oh, well, that was the end of the interview. And he had some woman on the phone with him. Here's the other thing. Famous people come on. We had to do this with Gene Hackman, but that was fine because they told us not to ask him about acting, and then we talked to him about acting, and remember he said he got in a fist fight at the bus stop? Remember that, Garrett? Were you here for Gene Hackman?
Yeah.
Oh, my God. And he had his buddy with him, and I didn't say two words to his buddy. You know, I tried to, but Gene Hackman ended up to be very cool. And I interviewed Spike Lee once, who comes off like he's mad at you and everything else. But that turned out okay also. But Eddie Izzard, I really was surprised that he was the way he was. He's got a lot to hide, that guy, that Eddie Izzard.
Well, the first time I ever even heard of him, I saw him on an HBO special when he did the whole thing in drag. And it was so funny, I was crying. And he's just never really had a big sense of humor since. I don't know what happened. Maybe that's his only shtick.
Do you know that he is a transvestite that likes women? Did you know that? He is not gay. I mean, now he might be, and he may have had gay experiences, but he says that he is a cross-dresser who likes women.
You don't think it's just a thing, just to stand out? Like Dice always wears his leather jacket and does his nursery rhymes or something. That's just, he just stumbled into it?
No. I saw this guy with high heels, a dress, makeup, earrings, the fingernails, and everything. He looked just like, I mean, he looked like a very ugly woman, but he was dressed just like a woman. And no, that was not a bit. I mean, that wasn't a bit. Yeah. And I found that to be kind of interesting. You know what's crazy about women? I've seen more models marry gay guys than anything else in the world. Christina, would you ever fall in love with a man who wore dresses but loved women?
No.
Really?
Really.
There's a guy that worked at Sirius that wears a kilt.
I'm okay with kilts once a month, but I'm not.
He wears
a
kilt once a month.
Yeah.
God, I hope it's one of the months that I'm there. I've never seen anybody with a kilt at the Sirius XM. Oh, wait a minute. We went to look at a college with the kids, right? And so what you do is you go with the guys and you look around the campus and they let you sit in on a class, right? So we're walking across the campus. I forget what campus it was. And there was a guy. It was Lewis and Clark, I think, in Portland, Oregon. There was a guy with a kilt. And I turn to my kid and go, look at that fucking asshole, like that. Well, guess who was the teacher when he went in to sit in and, you know, the guy with the kilt. So I said, what were you thinking? He goes, I kept wanting him to bend over. You know, drop a pencil. You know, I mean, he must have to worry how he sits and everything, right, with a kilt.
Yeah.
Because it's kind of short, isn't it?
Above the knee.
Of course it is. Yeah. So when you sit, you know, your balls will be flapping out. All right. Well, Jeff, it was wonderful spending a moment or two with you. Is the hurricane coming toward you guys?
It's going to be about 300 miles offshore, probably Wednesday evening, Thursday.
And then what's out there? Bermuda? It's going to hit Bermuda, something like that?
No, I think it's coming between us and Bermuda. I think they're just thinking it's going to basically shadow the coast. Maybe the Outer Banks are going to get a little bit more than us, but I don't think, at least as of this morning, it was going to come aground.
Okay, all right. But it's not going toward New Orleans, is it?
No, well, I don't know. That may be the first one, maybe. The first one's going beneath Florida, at last I saw. But the second one, Earl, was going to be the one that I'm thinking of because that's the one that's got more of a bead on us.
My God, there's two of them out there? Jesus Christ.
Well, there's actually three of them. There's another one way back there.
Jesus. Three of them. Yeah. Now, that for sale sign's going up in front of my property in New Orleans, I'm telling you right now. Going up. Sure. I can't take another hurricane. All right. Thank you, Jeff, very much. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah. By the way, we will have a woman on who's written a book called Death for Beginners. She believes that you should start thinking about it and embrace it. Now, you know, I'm scared to death of death, frightened of death. So we will talk to her about that. And, of course, before the day is over, we'll take another one of our holiday road trips, this time to the big cow chip throw. Stay where you are. Only about a week left. Go to Jay Thomas Show at SiriusXM.com. And in the subject matter, you know, you email me. You put the holiday road, recommend something. We'll draw, Ira the Weatherman will draw after September the 3rd, okay? Many people have said, will Ira ever get his own show? Well, Labor Day, we're talking about him hosting a Labor Day special. Is that not correct, Garrett?
That is true.
Now, Garrett announced to me today that Ira was going to host a Labor Day special. Now, you would think that as the main host of the show, the man whose name is over the door, the man who, when you hear the show, that's Jay Thomas, and they say my name 20, 30 times, I would have been a part of that meeting. But I wasn't. I was not a part of the meeting. And I'll say this now live. Whenever you get called in with the other producers of the channels, and when you guys make an important decision about what's going to run on this show, make sure I'm not there because I don't give a shit, okay? The last thing I want to be in is a fucking meeting where people decide what, you know, people always go, well, what do you do when they tell you to do something you don't want to do? I do it. I do it. That's all. They pretty much told me, leave Glenn Beck alone. They're happy that he's here. Millions of people listen to him. That's it. Glenn Beck's left alone. That's it. You know? I mean, I've already said I think he's, kind of a kook. But, I leave him completely. And, you talk about Howard. Be careful. Don't curse when you're on the NFL channel, right? We have rules. Right?
Oh, that's NFL right. Fantasy channel?
Yeah, and of course, I wasn't there 5 minutes. I said, fuck, that was an accident.
1 minute.
But, 1 minute. Well, I didn't say it again, did I? No.
No, that's true.
Happened to me. But sure, because you know what? Here's the truth. There are lots of other things to talk about and make fun of, right? You don't have to make fun of every single thing you need to make fun of. And I learned that a long time ago. How did I learn that, Garrett? How did I learn that lesson?
I don't know.
Because I made fun of some shit I shouldn't have, and they fired me. They would tell me look, whatever you do, don't say anything about so-and-so. Mm-hmm. Okay. I'm back on the air. Blah, 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 blah. Psh, see you later. Told you. Warned you. Yeah, I learned my lesson. Then you got to go home and tell your wife you've been fired. Okay? That's the worst thing about marriage. When you're alone and you get fired, you feel badly and everything else, but so what? The worst phone call is, what's the matter? Oh, my God. And they go like this. Did you lose your job? Like, yeah. Oh, no, I knew it. That's the next thing they say. I go, how did you know it? Because they were telling you not to do things and you did it, didn't you? Oh, yeah, I heard it all. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. Once her uncle committed suicide and we had just had our second kid. So, and the uncle had MS or something and killed himself because his quality of life was going to change. So you can see the kind of family I live in. Of course, I can't get my mother-in-law to do the same thing, but that's all right. She'll go eventually. But You know, she's in terrible pain. I go, you know, your brother kind of took care of that, you know, when the pain was really bad, you know, So, she has to leave with almost a newborn baby and go up to Seattle to bury her uncle. I'm left with the other one and the nanny and the wait, we had everything. We had cooks, we had guys, they fire me while she's gone. Okay. They can me. I got to call her just before the funeral and tell her that I got canned. Tell her that I got fired. Oh my God. What, you know, that's the worst. That's the worst. The only good time we were in New York and, she had cancer and 9/11 happened.
This is the only good time.
It's the only good time. I guess that didn't come off well. Did it? A friend of mine had stolen almost all of my retirement money. Okay. 300,000. So 300 grand was out the window. A guy like my dad, okay, stole all of our money. And his wife, like my parents, right, took all of my money. For those of you who live in Charlotte, North Carolina, you know who I'm talking about. They were like my fucking parents. He's dead, and she can't die a worse death. And I'm going to add to that her daughter. How about that? And the daughter was like my sister, and these two were like my parents. I want her to have pain at death like you've never seen pain before. So my 300 grand's out the window. 9/11 happens. Oh, all of our real estate deals went. My wife has cancer, and they fire me. I call my wife up, and she goes, "What's going on?" I go, "I get fired." She said, "Thank Christ, let's get the fuck out of here." That's what she said. And I drove home, and we called a moving company, and we packed everything up, and she said, "Promise me that we will never, ever move again, ever, as long as we live. I don't care if we live in a one-bedroom apartment, you know, at the YMCA. Promise me we'll go back to California and never move again." And I said, "We will never move again." And that was the only time she was happy that I got fired. So I go into the office at this big radio company. Also, it's Clear Channel. They canned me. They weren't mean to me. They just, you know, they fired me. So they call me in, and I think that they're going to retool my show. They fired everybody else, right? They told me the day before they're firing everybody but keeping me because I'm the linchpin of the company. That's what they told me. Well, of course, I go in. They fire me. And they give me a check for, like, what's left over of my contract. The general manager goes over to me and says, hugs me and goes, "God, I wish I was going with you." Can you imagine? And I called my agent. I said, "They fired me." So Buckwall says, "Did they give you a check?" I go, "Yeah." "Get it over here right away. We got to get it in the bank." Nobody cared that I was upset or like, you know, my wife said, "Let's get the fuck out of here." You know, that was it. That was it. Wow. So anyway. You know what, though? I tell you what. I haven't been fired since. Yeah. What time is it? We'll be right back. When this woman comes on, by the way, we'll let you ask questions if you keep. I always hate to open the phones before a guest gets killed. 888-4102-102. I'm going to ask her if they would bury me with my ass out of the ground and you could park your bicycle in it. Remember that joke, Garrett?
Or some people could come by and kiss it or whatever.
Kiss my ass. Yeah, all of that. We'll ask our guests all of that. You will not believe what Lindsay Lohan's father has announced he is opening. You cannot guess what he's opening, Garrett. Just guess.
God, a bar?
No, the opposite.
A rehab center?
Thank you. Stay where you are. That's in the headlines. That's coming up.
Here we go.
What an idiot.
It's got to be good money, at least.
Well, that's true, yeah. Takes one to know one.
Death for Beginners. That's right, D-E-A-T-H, deathforbeginners.com. And the book written by Karen Jones. Karen, welcome to the Jay Thomas Show at Sirius XM. How are you?
I'm just fine, Jay. How are you? I love the music is great.
Well, we can play anything we want. Now, I lived in Charlotte forever. I was at Big Ways in Charlotte and ROQ. Aren't you on the air somewhere in North Carolina?
No, I was on FM 99 WNOR Rock and Roll in Virginia, Norfolk, Virginia, and then on 106.9 The Fox. But right now, I'm still doing TV off and on at WVEC 13 in Norfolk. So I'm just kind of everywhere.
You're in Norfolk. It's Virginia you're in, not North Carolina.
Right, it's Virginia.
Okay.
And right now I'm in San Diego because I'm on a book tour, so it's scaring people to death. So,
well, here's the thing. I happen to be one of the people that's frightened of death, but at the same time very attracted to it. And so the fact that you're not a doctor or a psychologist or a mortuary owner or whatever, what made you write Death for Beginners?
My co-anchor on 13 had a tragedy in her life. Her 19-year-old sister was killed in a pedestrian accident, and I watched the funeral industry try to take advantage of her, you know, and I thought, you know, this isn't going to happen anymore. This isn't going to happen on my watch, because when somebody dies, I don't care if you expect it, your brain just shuts down, and you're buying goods and services with a kind of a foggy brain. So I decided to go at this subject as a man on the street, not as somebody with insider knowledge, not as somebody with something to sell or a drum to beat, but somebody who didn't know anything. So I started from ground zero, and I think I've covered a lot of things that somebody in the industry might take for granted and leave out.
Well, when my mother passed away, my brother and I, we consciously did not want to spend a bunch of money.
Absolutely.
Right? We just didn't. I mean, there's some people that wanted us, you know, and we've always said, oh, we're going to have this big party for, we never even had a party for her. But we loved her. But, you know, she was one of these, you know, when you're gone, you're gone. But I remember the different prices they gave us for cremation.
Yeah.
Right? We were in there with a guy had died, and he was really huge, like he weighed over 300 pounds. And we could hear the conversation in the next room. And I think it cost $2,500 to cremate. Does that sound, I mean, it's
no,
in Louisiana.
No, if you have a direct cremation where the body is taken directly to the crematorium from, you know, where they died, depending on the area of the country in which you live, it can be $300, $350 for a direct cremation with no big coffin or anything like that. They kind of put the body in the cardboard box and away you go. And then you've got the ashes to do great stuff with. So
wait, I'm going to call my brother because I think it was a couple of grand at least.
See, that's the thing about this book, and it is such a quick workbook kind of a thing. You're not reading 600 pages on death, all right? You're reading a book that's written almost in bullet point.
No, wait. You mean to tell me that I could have said to this guy, who seemed very nice,
oh, yeah.
Excuse me, I just read Karen Jones' book, Death for Beginners, and she says that I can get my mother cremated for $350. He would have said, maybe you can, sir, but, you know, but not here. And then where do we go next?
Where do you go next? Well, you do your research. You do your research beforehand.
Well, she's on ice. She was on ice. She wasn't feeling a thing.
Yeah, well, the thing is that you call a couple of different crematoriums. You can also join this really cool group, and it's like, I don't know, you pay, it's a one-time pay thing. It's called the Funeral Consumers Alliance. And you call them up, and they give you price costs all the way across the board for absolutely everything. I have that in my book. It's a really cool group to join. But, yeah, you do want to do comparison shopping. And if you go ahead and plan ahead, you know, my book has all these worksheets in it where you just fill these suckers out, and then you put them in a file, and it's over with. So when you die, you just, you know, somebody pulls out the file and goes, oh, yeah, he wants to be cremated. And Karen's book says, you know, you can do it for $300, $400 or whatever, depending. Let's do this. Let's do that. I'm big on pre-planning, so you don't waste a ton of money. Because you know what? Today, a typical funeral, traditional funeral, Jay, costs about $9,000, and that's not the cemetery plot.
Nobody has any. You know what? You got to be. Nobody has any money.
Well, and nobody has any money. And
people keep dying. So when everybody was like, you know, flush.
Yeah.
You know, you'd spend $5,000 to $10,000 on a funeral, and the
the Michael Jackson casket. All right?
No, but you know what? The church, my cousins were very Catholic from Louisiana. They would not cremate them.
Yeah.
I bet you their funerals cost $10,000-$15,000. They were all laid out in a beautiful casket, and they had, now, is there any way that you have like the nice casket?
And yeah, then, it's called rent-a-casket, Jay.
You can rent the casket.
You can rent a casket, even if you're going to bury them in a pine box or even if you're going to cremate them. You can rent a casket for the viewing and a little service.
Because there's no blood. There's no blood's going to ooze out or ruin it, right?
No. They either embalm them or they keep them refrigerated. And do you know that there's no law that says you have to pay for embalming, that you have to embalm anybody? There's no law that says that. I mean, you might if you have
to. But don't they stink after a few days? Isn't that the thing?
But they refrigerate the body. And if you are going to transport a body across state lines, there are some states that require embalming for transport. But basically, you do not have to embalm a body. You can have it refrigerated, and then you can have it cremated. And then they give you the cremains, which creeps me out. I call them ashes. They give you ashes in a little cardboard box. You do not have to buy the big old fancy urn.
We went through that, too. They went...
Unbelievable.
They went down the line, and one of them was an urn was $1,000. So my brother and I said, look, do you have something, and we meant this, almost like a coffee can, you know?
Right.
And the guy, for $250, and my brother has it in his office, for $250, my mother is in something that looks like, you know, a genie bottle, coffee can kind of a thing. But I remember going, why in the hell did we pay $250? Now, have they blogged against you? Has the industry blogged against death for beginners?
Actually, they haven't. I haven't gotten any grief from any of the funeral industry as of yet. I think they realize that my intentions are good, and I do not talk badly about the funeral industry in this book. That's not what the book is about. The book is how to plan it and save money, and then use the money for a big old party if you're going to do that. But think about it. Think about that blue polyester leisure suit you might have worn in the 70s. Do you want that picture of you on your memorial table?
Well, the other thing is everybody looks awful in the casket. I mean, it hasn't gotten any better.
It hasn't.
It looks,
do you know there's a new trend now? Plastic surgery after death. I'm not kidding you. There is this new thing where you can have plastic surgery once you're dead so they can go by your coffin and go, girl, she looks so good.
But I did not recognize my two cousins and a friend of my brother's. They didn't look like themselves, and they were ill when they died, but they still looked better. So, what is that? How is it some people look good in the coffin and some don't? That's just luck?
No, I don't think it's luck. I actually think there's literally an art to making people look good after they're dead. And truly, some of these people in the funeral homes are just geniuses with it. They can make someone look absolutely beautiful, and it just depends on the level of artistry of the person who works there. It really is very different from one funeral home to the next.
Now, do you write about the cryogenics thing where you freeze your head?
Yeah.
Now, that's very expensive.
That's extremely expensive. But did you know that you can freeze yourself for like $160,000, but did you know that you can just freeze your head alone?
Right. Ted Williams' head was just frozen. That's
it. and it fell down and cracked.
I heard that they had it propped up on a can, and the can stuck to it, and then when they pulled the can off, it cracked his head. Did it fall and really crack?
Yeah, that's in my book. It really kind of did crack, and I have the link to the site where you can read all about it, and that's in my book. And the cool thing with the book is when I give you every single option you ever wanted, I define it, I give you pros and cons and costs and how to do it, and then there are three links for almost every single option. And you can go right to the website, and I refresh the links all the time, so you don't have to do really heavy-duty research. It's just right there for you to click on.
Now, when Ted Williams comes back, let's just say it works.
Okay.
They are going to, like, in a couple hundred years, they will rebuild him.
Yeah.
And that's what the deal is that they're going to take his head and the DNA, I guess, or whatever, and they're going to rebuild Ted Williams himself?
You know, they don't really know. They tell you they're unsure of when what the technology will be or when it will appear. But they say that it's nanotechnology and that it will happen. And so in a small way, you are gambling But you can just have your head frozen for $80,000, and then I guess they just give you a body. I'm thinking Angelina Jolie for me.
But I think that you could make, they think you could make a ball player as good as Ted Williams. I think that's what they're looking at. It's like a superhuman deal.
Well, I think so, too. It's very interesting to go up on their websites and read them, but it's incredibly expensive. It's because you have to pay an entry fee and, you know, fees, that, and you have to put money aside, so they get money every month for you being frozen, and it's just it's a terribly expensive thing to do. But if you
could,
could you
be buried with a video camera? I mean, there's
They did that out in Seattle. They buried somebody, and he had a live feed of his decomposing body. I couldn't do it, man. I couldn't go to the website.
Is that online? Is that still online?
I don't know if it's still online. I'm telling you, it was there about a year ago, and it really creeped me out. But do you know what you can do now? This is great for all of us baby boomers. On your little memorial place, you know, your little tombstone, they now have a solar-activated video display that when somebody comes by, you can have your own video display. And instead of just looking at your tombstone, they can, like, see a vid of you.
What do you mean as you walk by, you're talking to the, well, I've seen, by the way, that's really creepy. I've been to the funeral where the guy spoke after he was dead.
Yeah. But
and I want to tell you, that is it's very uncomfortable. I know the family liked it. Very uncomfortable.
Oh, well, you know. It is. But the thing is death is so weird because it is completely individualized. Everybody has their certain little yucks and their laughter, and it's just amazing to talk to people about this subject.
Can I be buried at sea?
Absolutely. You can. Your ashes can either be buried at sea or your...
No, not my ashes. No.
Your body.
Yeah, I want my body to slide under that tarp or whatever they have.
Yeah, then you need to go to my website. It's New England Burials at Sea, and they will. Mm-hmm. They even have special little marine coffins and sailcloths that they use to just jettison you right out to sea. It is as expensive as a regular burial because you're getting the regular coffin. Obviously, they're not going to really embalm you, but you're going to have to pay for the gas to get the boat out past the 5-mile limit and that type of thing.
Because the government won't let. The government has a limit. They don't want you buried.
Right.
You have to be in international waters?
Well, no, they don't want you buried too close in. I mean,
do they weight your body down so that you go right to the bottom? How does that work?
Absolutely. That in the bottoms of these coffins, they have ballast stones, you know, like they used to use in the old ships.
Yeah, sure, sure.
And it sinks you all the way down. It's really cool.
Death for Beginners. Now, deathforbeginners.com, Karen Jones. Now, you're bubbly. You're very bubbly. Mm-hmm. Are you frightened of death?
You know, I'm really not. I think it's the next great adventure. I really do, and I'm not.
You think something's going to happen?
I think we go somewhere, we do something. I am not sure what, but I think it's I think it's very Star Trek, and I think it's just the next great adventure. My body, of course, is afraid of it. I mean, you know, you get the adrenaline hit when you get that near miss with the idiot who's driving and texting. But
right.
Yeah, mentally, nah, not at all.
Now, what about if I wanted to be mummified? Is that legal to be mummified?
You absolutely can be mummified. Right now, the going cost for mummification is about $67,000, and I know there is one group that still does it. You can look it up on my website. But yeah,
is Stalin mummified or is Mao? First of all, they look perfect, by the way.
Yeah,
Stalin looks like Stalin, and Mao looks like Mao. Aren't they in the glass tombs, right?
Yeah, I don't know what exactly they did to them, but I do know it's like a chamber that is completely sealed and there's no oxygen, and I just...
But they look perfect. Stalin looks like he's asleep.
I know, it's creepy, isn't it?
Well, I don't know if it's creepy or not, but I was just saying, my cousins and my buddy, their face was kind of flattened. It was like, mm-hmm. It was silly putty, you know?
Yeah.
You know what? They're in small towns, so I guess the person
exactly.
that does it was no good.
Exactly, and you really do need somebody, and there's an art to it. I mean, they put all kinds of things up in their mouths and on their cheekbones, and it's amazing what some of them do a really good job. But again, it's up to the funeral home that you choose. You know,
Costco and Walmart. When you walk in, the caskets are for sale right there. Are those a good deal?
Yeah, they really are. They're a better deal generally than a great big huge funeral home. Actually, Jay, do the pine box. You can build your own coffin. They have coffin building classes. They have coffin building kits on the internet. You can use a pine box. There is no law that says what you have to be buried in.
Can I be buried like, let's say, I think you have it here under your grandmother's tree, but that's, I have some property around. Could I, don't you have to get a permit to be buried on property?
The thing with home burial in your own lot, is that it is very hyper-local. There wasn't room to write down the laws for every single city in the United States, so you do have to go to your city, and the medical examiner is probably the good place to start and say, you know, what are the rules for burying on my property? Some towns will let you do it, some towns won't. It's extremely hyper-local.
Because the dog will dig you up.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. Wouldn't that be awful, though? You get buried and your dog runs around with your femur or something in the backyard? You know?
Actually kind of interesting, but you know, the green burial movement is huge. The green burial movement
could
is
I be buried with my ass sticking out of the ground? You know that old joke, so people can come by and either kiss it or park their bike
well,
in it.
Darling, if you get buried on your own property, I bet you can
put my ass out there. Well, listen, good luck. And then, and how are you going? You're going to be going cheap? Have you given instructions to
I'm going to be dragged from wherever I'm dead. I'm going to be immediately cremated and sprinkled in the Chesapeake Bay, and then we're going to have a big rock and roll party right on the beach.
What could we have gotten if we'd have sold my mother's body to the hospital or to the university?
You can't sell a body. You don't get any money at all. There are.
Can we donate it?
You can donate it, and
would it be free? Would that be the end of the deal?
Yeah, you donate it, and they take the body. Some medical schools will return the ashes cremated once they're finished with them, and some will not. You can also donate your body to the body farm, which is really cool, Jay.
You know what? I read about the body farm. Garrett, Garrett, do you know what the body farm is?
Yeah, there are four of them. They're forensic anthropology centers, and there are four of them. One's in North Carolina and West.
I'm going to have them on the show. They lay the bodies out on the ground, and then they watch them decompose.
I thought they also like stuff them in a trunk and send the car into a lake and then see what happens, or they put them in a plastic bag, you know, all different scenarios.
And you know, I just read about that in Scientific American just like this month. I have never heard of this before.
I have some links on my website, and what they do is their students go out and measure the weather, and then they measure the decomposition rate every single day, and this is used in court cases to convict killers for time of death.
Well, I know that what they do is, and you know, it's like Silence of the Lambs, right? Mm-hmm. When the guy put the butterfly the what do you call it, the worm in the mouth, the little caterpillar, right? I know that these forensic, in fact, those shows to me are more interesting. They've kind of gotten away from them, the ones where they find the dead body and they have the dirt and they go, it was this time of year and this leaf was near their body and they couldn't have been killed there because this dirt.
I love that.
Yeah, they don't have the, those shows aren't as big as they started. The CSI started like that, and now it's not the same. But the thing is that does it stink at the body farm?
I would think so. Yeah, because those are decomposing bodies, and they just wear little surgical masks and probably the Vicks vapor rub under, you know, the nose, and that's it, and they rock.
But how far do you have to be from other people, because the stench of death.
They are way out there. UT at Knoxville is way out, and in Western Carolina, the body farms are way, way far away. You know, and of course, they're just surrounded by all kinds of wire fences and barbed wire and things, so you don't get goofy people climbing over, because, you know, people are weird.
So they'll take some bodies and lay them in a field.
Sure.
They'll take some and put them in a trunk and put them in the water. What else do they do, Garrett? What else would they can't shoot them.
They set them on fire. They hang them in trees.
Oh, come on.
Yeah, they do everything.
No, they don't. They don't hang a body in a tree.
Yeah.
Oh, God. For what? To see what?
I guess, if the birds are going to get them, or if the insects can actually climb that high to lay eggs and stuff. No, really, and it's a great thing to do. It just sounds really creepy, but you are donating your body to science, and that, you know, it's a good thing to do if you can stand doing it.
Well, so I would donate my body to the body farm.
Yep.
You think when they went in, hey, I just saw this guy's rerun the other night.
Exactly,
you know,
that'd be a hoot.
And then they're waiting for me to decompose.
Yeah.
Right?
Sad.
Now what, you know what, Garrett? We got to get to. You know anybody that would be fun to fun to talk to?
There's a great body farm book out there. I'm trying to find it right now, but I heard.
Well,
a lot
definitely
about
want
it.
To get a person from the body farm out there.
Hey,
well,
yeah,
listen.
Go to my website because I have links to the different body farms. Okay.
Okay.
My mother used to say, Oh, my God, if we knew how wonderful death was, we'd all be killing ourselves. She would say that. She said that's why God made us frightened of death, mm-hmm. because it must be wonderful.
Right? Well, I agree with your mom. I think it's
well, that's what she said. She was never afraid to die, and I'm scared to death. But Death for Beginners, go to deathforbeginners.com, and then there, of course, is the book, Karen Jones. And you are in the Norfolk, Virginia area.
Yep, right in Virginia Beach.
And you are a newscaster?
Yeah, I was, and a weathercaster also. So
you did the weather?
And went on the road with rock and roll bands and did entertainment reporting before everybody did it.
But were you a groupie? Did you sleep with any big stars?
No, I didn't, because just think. Think about where they've been. You know what I'm saying? No way. No, I didn't do the groupie thing, and they were...
You didn't meet one rock star that you were attracted to?
Sting is a really big flirt. He was really attractive, but
wife would sleep with Sting tonight.
Well, honey, most women would sleep with Sting tonight.
Well, you have him wear a condom.
Well, you know, I saw him doing his yoga stuff. He had on like a little Speedo swimsuit and was doing his yoga stuff backstage. And I'm telling you, I just stood there and said, life is good. I like my job.
All right. So that's it. All right. And of course, you're a Southern lady, so you would never talk anyway.
Oh, Lord, child, we don't tell.
We don't. Karen Jones, Death for Beginners. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Jay.
Thank you. Now we're getting the phone calls. That's all right. Let's go to Jim of Hartford real fast. We can call her back if anything. Yes, Jim, it's Jay.
She's off the line now?
Yeah, but go ahead. If it's a good enough question, I'll call her back.
Well, all this sexy talk and stuff about death and her pretty Southern drawl, I just had a cremation in my hand. I just wanted to tell her.
Okay, you know what? That's why I didn't have anybody ask her questions, you animals. Now, you know what? That's that bubbly Southern thing, you know? You got to live down there to understand that, okay? It doesn't sound... You know what's great about those women, Garrett? No one would ever believe they did anything with anybody. You know what I mean?
Okay? So sweet.
And kind of business-like, almost, mm-hmm. you know? And their lipstick is perfect, and their makeup, and guess what? I lived down there my whole life, okay? Okay? Twist them like a top. Okay. Turn them every which way but loose, Garrett. Let's go to Mike of New Jersey. Yes, Mike, it's Jay Thomas. How are you?
Hey, Jay, how are you?
Good.
Hey, listen, I was hoping to ask that woman, I don't know if you heard about this, you're going to have to do a search for it, maybe Garrett can find it, but there's a nun that died like 100 or 200 years ago. Mm-hmm. Her body is laid out in one of the cathedrals or one of these churches. Her body was not mummified, was not embalmed, and to this day, her body is perfect condition from like the day she died. They cannot explain it.
Well, no, wait a minute. The only way it can be that there's only one way is whatever she is in is hermetically sealed. It cannot have any air, and there can be no blood in her body.
And I'm telling you, if you find, ask Garrett to do a search.
All right, Garrett. Hold on. Call her back. Call her back. This is a good question.
Yeah, and what it is that she's apparently being beautified as a saint because they're saying that her body's sitting there.
It's not beautified. It's beatified.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It's different. That's okay. I'm a Catholic. But it's beatified. But what it means is she's being basically sainted is what she's being.
Exactly.
So they're saying that because her body has never decomposed, that she is something godlike or something incredibly special.
And I think also to do with the way she lived her life prior to her death. It's either 100 or 200 years ago.
So, Mike, you mean if you live an incredibly boring life and your body is... you never have any sexual pleasure. you will lay for eternity. You know what? My body, I should be wrinkled and I should look like a scab within 24 hours of my death. All right.
Jay, when I die, I'll have rigor mortis in about 30 seconds from all this.
We are bringing Karen Jones back. Karen,
hi.
It's Jay Thomas again.
Hey.
By the way, Karen, we've brought a few guests back. It never turns out well, but the phones were lighting up. You know, this is uncensored, and so prepare yourself, Karen.
People okay, baby.
Will say. Okay.
Okay.
Mike of New Jersey, you brought something up. Karen has written Death for Beginners. Mike, explain to Karen what you were asking about.
Hi, Karen. Yeah, this is Mike from Jersey, and there's a nun that's being considered for, I guess, sainthood. How do you say it, Jay?
Beatification.
Okay.
There you go. And apparently her body has been laying out in a church or a cathedral somewhere, she's been dead for either 100 or 200 years, and nothing has decomposed on her body.
Oh.
Are you aware of this? It's on the internet. There's a picture.
I saw one of these when I was in Italy. And
yes,
you just walk by the church, and in the wall they'll have all these mummies, and then all of a sudden you'll run across one that looks like it died yesterday. I think it has to do with the dry conditions. That's the only thing I can think of. Because I don't
know
that
the thing that I'm saying is that if you read the article on it, there was nothing done to the body, so that's why... It's also considered a miracle.
Well, yeah, there you go.
Now, wait. I've been to Italy. I didn't go to the churches where the dead bodies. I've been in the catacombs where the skulls are.
Right.
There are churches where you walk by and there is a dead body.
Yeah,
just staring. Staring.
Yeah, it's in the wall and it's behind, and they have like a little glass so you can see it.
Yeah.
And oh yeah, and some of that really, really old cathedrals in Italy in the small towns, you bet. And you just go, well, hiya.
what Mike was saying was, now she's probably being beatified, Mike, because of her good works and all
right.
that. But I was saying that the only way she wouldn't decompose is if she was in a vacuum.
Right, and she's laid out. She's not even in, there's nothing... Cover.
He says that he thinks she's laid out in the air. I can't imagine.
Wow. Then it must be a miracle. Maybe it's just because the area was so dry. What area is it? Is it in like...
Well, you know, Zsa Zsa Gabor looks like that, don't you think? Zsa Zsa Gabor is perfect, and she's been dead for...
Well,
she's not dead yet.
She had a last rite
for 2 weeks ago, and she's still hanging on.
She's still hanging on? Well, she's dead. All right, Mike, thank you very much. Mike.
Thank you.
All right. Now, let's go to Tom of Pittsburgh. Yes, Tom, it's Jay Thomas. We brought Karen Jones back, Tom.
Jay, I was wondering, you need a casket to be buried? Can you just dig a hole and get thrown in there?
There's no law that says that you must have a casket. Here's the deal. It's the cemeteries that demand not only a casket, but that big concrete vault that goes over the casket so they're... tractors won't crush in and fall in the hole. You can be buried in almost anything you want to, as long as the cemetery that you're going to be buried in agrees with it.
So you're saying that the concrete is there to protect the tractors from going into a hole?
Right. If you look at the really, really old cemeteries there, where people have been buried before, they sink down because everything rots. And in the newer cemeteries nowadays, most of them require that you purchase a vault. And a vault is steel and concrete, and it covers the casket, and it makes it so they can run their tractors all over and that nothing sinks down.
Is New Orleans the only place where they, and maybe Venice, where they bury people above ground? People, you know, nobody is buried below ground in southern Louisiana. We're all buried above ground.
Right, right. I think it's just, I don't know. Well, a lot of people are built in those, in little mortuaries that are above ground, and like they're in Arizona. So it's just that some people want to be buried above ground in a casket in a little teeny mortuary house. You know, because they just don't want to go underneath the dirt.
There are people that think that they're going to feel the bugs eating them.
Yeah, and I think they're probably wrong.
Yeah, they are wrong.
Unless maybe they're serial killers, and then that would be a good thing.
Right. All right. Thank you very much. Ken of New Haven, we brought Karen Jones back. She's written a book about death that will be a bestseller long after she is gone. Death for Beginners.
I would like to bury my tongue in her asshole.
All right, you see that? There you go. All right, that's it. Karen, I told you it doesn't turn out well, and it doesn't.
Well, you know, I mean, you've got people that just have to say that kind of stuff. They can't help
it. Well, prior to that, the word cremation was used in a very unsavory way.
Well, there you go.
Thank you very much.
And what can you do, you know?
Well, first of all, I set it up by saying, God forbid, don't say anything. So that's it.
Oh, and so Karen, they're going to call
Jones, them. Thank you very much. Thank you, Karen. Thank you so much.
My pleasure.
All right. Bury his tongue in her asshole. But what was his question supposed to be, Christina?
She's on the phone.
How do you open a cemetery? You know, don't do that to these people. They're not used to that. Actually, you see that, Garrett? She took that pretty well.
She did.
She did. She did. I may have to call her back when I'm off the air.
Ooh.
Hey, Karen J. Thomas.
You like her sporty haircut?
No, you know, she's a little too perky for me. She's nice, but she's too perky. You'd have to go late into the night. You'd have to talk a long time, you know, late into the night. Be a lot of jabbering, as we like to say, you know.
About death.
About everything, you know. There would just be a lot of talk. Let's go to... Greg of Ohio. Yes, Greg, it's Jay Thomas. How are you?
Good, Jay. How are you doing?
Good, thank you.
Yeah, my mother-in-law's casket, they had to drill holes in the top of it so the worms could come out and puke.
Oh, God. All right, thank you, Greg. I like Greg's deadpan delivery, by the way, so that they could come out and puke, you know. Bob of Missouri. Yes, Bob. Go ahead, Bob.
Well, I was going to ask you about cremation and how it does work. A friend of mine was talking to a mortician recently, and he said they separate, I guess, the meat from the bones and before they do the cremation. So.
No, they don't.
He said it was kind of gross, but that's
what I was told that they... Now, here's the thing with the 300-pound guy. They were charging extra. And my brother and I are waiting for our turn to talk to this guy, and we could hear through the wall this discussion. And I believe they were showing a price list, and it was much more expensive, and you could hear the guy going, well, why is that? She goes, well, you know, your father was 6'4", and he weighed 340 pounds. And I'm thinking, I think there's only one opening to the crematorium. You know what I mean? There's only one size opening. I'm thinking that maybe the charge had to be for chopping the bastard up. You know what I mean? They might have had to cut him into sections before they put him in there. Because they charged more for the overweight guy, but they made it sound like it would take him longer to burn, or they had to use more gas, or, you know, whatever. But they did charge more for the overweight big guy. But my brother and I are looking at each other going, Jesus Christ, don't you know they're going to slice the son of a bitch up? And, you know, God forbid. All right. Thank you, brother. All right. Thank you. All right. There we go. Now, all the way down at the bottom, there's a Michelle Obama, but that's not my normal Michelle Obama.
No, it's not. And this person has been calling for 2 or 3 days in a row. Or 2 days. What day is it? Tuesday? Yeah. Yesterday. Mm-hmm. All day yesterday.
I tell you what. On line four, we have not the person that's there, but I want to bring on the our voice doctor, Dr. Voice, and I want him to listen to this Michelle Obama. On line four. Dr. Voice, are you there, sir?
Oh, yeah.
Larry Flint, are you there, Larry? We have somebody on that says they are Michelle Obama.
I cannot wait to hear it.
All right.
Come on.
Bring them on. Oh. All right, let's go down to Michelle Obama. All right, here we go. Hello, Michelle. Go ahead.
Oh, hello. Is this the J. Thomas Show?
Yes, it is. But you know what? Hold it a second. This actually sounds like a woman.
I know, baby.
Oh, is that Rodney Lee Conover?
No, it isn't Rodney Lee Conover. Now, hold on a minute. Hold on, Larry. Yes, yes, Michelle, go ahead.
I've been trying to call you for about 2 or 3 days, you cute little thing.
You know what? Put Larry on hold.
All right.
How are you, Michelle?
I'm doing good. I've been down to Spain. I got my hair did. Oh, I'm good. Listen, you know Barack gonna fix up the Gulf, don't you?
I do.
He gonna do everything that Bush was supposed to do, but he gonna do it right.
Mm-hmm. We may have to hire a writer for you, okay?
Well, awesome. And you know, everybody comes to Pennsylvania Avenue. And, you know, it just ain't all it cracked up to be. I had to go all the way to Anacostia to get me some churches. Okay? That ain't right.
All right. Well, keep working. Keep working. It's the Jay Thomas Show, the home of the amateur voices. The woman that was just on is a local newscaster. And I tell you what, Garrett, she's no Sue Simmons, you know. Sue Simmons has been in New York for years and years, and she's an NBC Channel 4?
Correct, with Chuck Scarborough.
Chuck Scarborough. So years ago when I used to, you know, you'd go over and you'd do, you know, in L.A. too, you do more cable channels, you know, now. And I've done the Today Show and all of them, but I would do the afternoon shows and promote whatever. But Sue Simmons, you know, was always very haughty, you know, very like, you know, I mean, I've never understood. They're not really reporters. They're kind of news. They're news readers, really. And I mean, they're not out, you know, embedded with the Marines and every now and again, you know, but their days of going out in the street, you know, they'll be on the air just reading the teleprompter for, you know, 25, 30 years, right? So apparently she did not know the microphone was on last year. A little different than our friend Karen Jones. Can we hear Sue Simmons from last year? On the year, doing one of her famous promos.
At 11, paying more at the grocer, but getting less will tell you how to get the most. The fuck are you doing?
There you go. Lovely Sue Simmons, local announcer in New York City. What did she think was happening?
We need to acknowledge an unfortunate mistake that I made and one of the teases we bring to you before this program. While we were live just after 10 o'clock, I said a word that many people find offensive. I'm truly sorry. It was a mistake on my part, and I sincerely apologize.
Many people find offensive. Apparently, she doesn't. That's the way she said. Did you hear how haughty she was? Mm-hmm. Yeah, play her apology again. It's like, She, by the way, she should have said at the end, and if you don't accept my apology, what the fuck are you looking at? Try it again. Here we go. Let's hear the apology.
We need to acknowledge an unfortunate mistake that I made and one of the teases we bring to you before this program. While we were live just after 10 o'clock, I said a word that many people find offensive. I'm truly sorry. It was a mistake on my part, and I sincerely apologize.
Was that the most insincere apology you've ever heard?
Of course.
Many people find it offensive. How about every person in the world finds it offensive? That's why we say it so much.
That's the whole point of the word.
That's exactly correct, to offend. That's right. Isn't it amazing, though, that you've taken some of the most delightful things in the world, the thing that we all would like to be having all the time, and yet when you say it, it's a terrible insult, and it's a curse word. That is odd, isn't it? Why don't you go make love to yourself? Just doesn't have the same punch to it, does it?
No.
Hey, watch this. Hey, Christina.
Yes?
Why don't you go make love to yourself?
Huh? It's very intimate.
It's the same. Watch this. You know what? Go make love to yourself.
Still offensive. You know,
it is. Go make love to yourself.
I'm not offended yet.
Mm-hmm. I tell you what, Garrett, passionately kiss my penis. It's just not, you know. You know, how about this? Lick it down there.
Oh.
No, but I mean, really, you take these other words and they're, you know, but it's the most wonderful, you know, it's the most wonderful thing in the world. And when you're doing it, even when you're doing it with the sleaziest, slimiest individual, you know, it feels so good, right? And yet somehow it's an insult. That's weird, isn't it? That's odd, isn't it? It's like when someone says God damn it. That's a horrible, and it's weird. What? Why is that a terrible insult?
I never understood that one. I used to get yelled at all the time.
I know. And I never knew. How about this one? Well, shit. People go crazy when people say shit, right? Watch this. Defecation. It's the same thing. How about this?
Feces.
On the dashboard. You know? It's amazing to me, right? Yeah. What, you know, well, now women have word, you know, you cannot say anything about a woman's vagina. There's some words you cannot say. But the word vagina, you stupid vagina.
Vagina.
There you go. There you go.
Vagina.
There you go. What a useless show this is. Jesus, this is... I mean, I'm doing the thing, and I think it's useless. Jennifer Grey has had more plastic surgery. And she is going to be Dancing with the Stars. I like that.
This is the she best looks, cast.
She looks like Renee Zellweger. She does. Her new one. You know, it is a good cast.
It's a great cast. I can't...
I know what? I was trying to make fun of it. When I looked at the cast, now Sarah Palin's daughter is famous because she gave her vagina to a boy's penis who put sperm inside of her, and the unmarried underage person had a child out of wedlock. That's why she's famous?
Yep.
Now, if I wanted to say that another way... You mean she's famous for being a dumb little whore who let an asshole from Alaska fuck her and she had a kid? I said the same thing prior to that. Didn't I, Garrett? Didn't I, Christina?
Yes, except
I said the
you
same
didn't
thing.
Give any other word for vagina. That was the only thing I was waiting for.
Really? Oh. You know. Well, the thing is, and I read today that she's an actress. Did you read that?
Come on.
Aspiring actress.
To be in something other than reality television? Really?
Yeah, it said aspiring actress. That was the headline. And now you've got Kurt Warner, who is not saying, oh, you're going to be surprised that I'm dancing. I don't know if you know this or not, but his whole life is Jesus. You know that, right?
Mm-hmm.
So his announcement was, I want people to see me more than someone who cites scripture. And I'm thinking, who thinks that? We think you throw a football, right?
Bag groceries.
He's a grocery bagger. That's the last thing you think of him. Who else is on? It is a good cast.
Lawrence Henderson.
Who, you know what? We may be able to get old Florence on here, poor darling, but we should get old Florence on here.
Oh, I hope so.
Didn't she sleep with one of the guys?
Oh, really?
Yeah, she slept with one of the Brady Bunch. Which one?
Oh, probably the
Barry Williams went out on a date with her.
That was it.
But I don't think anything happened.
Barry Williams was Greg, right?
Greg Brady.
Yeah.
Greg Brady, Barry Williams.
They went on a date, like a real date?
Yeah, but that's the last. This was like 10 years ago. I heard it, but
I went out a couple of times with Robin Givens, and apparently I'm the only guy that didn't do anything with her. Okay,
I'm really interested to know about the Brady hookups.
You know what? Tell Andrea, and she's been on my show for years. She ought to come on. She'll come on. Who else? Betty White? Is she on?
I think it's like one remarkably
one old person.
Old, mm-hmm. Yeah. Brandy.
You the know singer her. Brandy?
Yep. Sitting up in my room. That girl.
Okay. All right.
Margaret Cho.
Boy, I don't get her career at all. I do not find her funny. You find her funny?
No, I don't. I mean, I associate her with the comic that just makes fun of her mother all the time. I don't think I've ever seen her do anything else.
I think she's moved past that, though. That's what everyone knew her for, and she's famous, but I think she turned lesbian and got an edge to her.
I believe she also has a clothing line. Audrina Patridge from
what
The Hills.
What are they called? Wait a minute. Lesbo Levi's. That's what she has now. You know what? I've watched her any number of times, and I just there's you don't laugh at that. I don't know what that is. I didn't laugh at her when she wasn't a lesbian, and I don't laugh at her when she's a lesbian now. You know, she looks like, you know, Mr. What's the guy from Karate Kid? What was that guy's name?
Mr. Miyagi.
She looks like Mr. Miyagi after he's had too much kimchi. You know, it always looks like she's smelling something bad too, doesn't it? Doesn't she have that kind of like smell something bad thing?
Yeah.
She looks like she's driving by the body farm all the time.
That's true.
Yeah, always going by the body farm
with her shoes off.
Yeah.
Who
else?
Audrina Patridge from The Hills.
Yeah, I don't watch those shows.
Okay, well, I'm very excited about that.
Is The Hills an acting show, or is that
a reality television show that's no longer on? It was with Lauren Conrad and that whole crew.
About Beverly
Heidi
Hills?
Heidi and Spencer.
It I knew who Heidi was.
Reality show, though.
Huh?
It was fake reality.
It was spun off originally. It was supposed to be reality. But then the last episode of the season, they gave it all away because they showed the whole movie set and everything. I was amazed. Anyway,
wow.
None of you guys would care. Anyway.
So you mean you believed?
I didn't believe it, but I didn't think that they would show that. I didn't think that they would. I thought that they would let you keep believing that most of it was real.
Well, I think that so much had been written that it was fake.
Right. That they just were like, yeah, screw
right,
it.
Right.
So Bristol Palin, Michael Bolton.
Oh, my God.
And
what
CNN
an asshole.
Says the crooner may be popular with the ladies, but he'll have to use his feet to win on this stage.
What a complete
He's
and utter
popular with what ladies?
90-year-old ladies. What a screaming asshole. I have been in his company 3 or 4 times. Now, Garrett, they put he and I, this is like on a weekend, not on a thing. He considers himself a great golfer. We were in the same cart together playing golf at a country club in Connecticut. He moved his bag after 9 holes because he thought my game was dragging him down. I swear to God.
He's Michael Bolton.
He's an idiot.
He's dragging you down just because
he's Michael Bolton. He's an idiot. Complete idiot. And he's the kind of guy that meets you like 10 times and doesn't know who you are. You know. What an idiot. And was he still with the blonde from Desperate Housewives?
Probably.
They would only get back with each other when their careers were floundering.
I remember seeing them like being filmed by TMZ or something.
Right.
Not too long ago.
Right. They're like the Burt Reynolds and Lonnie Anderson of the 21st century. All right. No, actually, I have to tell you, that is a good cast.
Wait. We're not done yet. Mike the Situation from the Jersey Shore.
Yeah, that's big. That's
David Hasselhoff.
Oh, Jesus.
Kurt Warner. Kyle Macy. He's from the Disney Channel series. That's So Raven. I don't know. And Rick Fox.
The basketball player?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Once married to actress Vanessa Williams.
Right. All right. There you go. So hard to make fun of that group until they start. Here we go.
Yeah, well, at least your name isn't Michael Bolton.
You know, there's nothing wrong with that name.
There was nothing wrong with it until I was about 12 years old and that no-talent ass clown became famous and started winning Grammys.
Hmm. Well, why don't you just go by Mike instead of Michael?
No way. Why should I change? He's the one who sucks.
Now, I will tell you that, you know, for a white guy with the long hair, I mean, I don't think he's a bad singer, but as a person, he's just like a prick. And what's with the hair and all that? And then, you know, he was sued by the Isley Brothers. I tell you what, we have somebody coming on. When we come back, you've got to play the two songs. He lost, I think, $20 million to the Isley Brothers. They accused him of stealing a song and the title and everything. When we come back, we'll do that.
Into something amazing. Holiday Road, the Jay Thomas Show.
Wow. It almost took me by surprise, Holiday Road. My goodness. Now, did somebody recommend this Holiday Road, Garrett Andrews?
Yes. His name is Ken something.
Ken something! Ken!
Brushaber.
Ken Brushaber.
Brushaber.
Brushaber. Good Lord.
It's Kevin.
Get a name. Kevin, I'm sorry. Kevin Brushaber submitted the Wisconsin state cow chip throw. Go to WISCowChip.com. And let's go now to our committee member, Marietta, is it Reuter? R-U-E-T-E-R. How are you?
I'm great. And you?
I'm good. Is it Reuter? Am I saying it right?
Well, I say it writer, but you can say it however you'd like.
I think I switched the E and the U, Jay, on the sheet.
Writer? Well, I'm going to say it properly. No, I can't. You know what? No. I don't want you to call me Thomas. So, writer. Or I'll just put it right there. Have you ever done a radio show before, Marietta?
Lots of times.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I'm sorry. But it's kind of a unique event, so people like to hear about it.
Really?
Yeah.
So, talking to me is nothing special.
Well, you're very special.
Mm-hmm. All right. I'll try and press on. Now, the cow chip throw in Wisconsin, is it at a state fair or something, or how does it work?
Nope, it's in a small community, Sauk City in Prairie du Sac.
Wait one second. I know this is uncensored, but you can't curse like that on the radio.
Sorry.
What did you say now? Where is it?
Sauk City in Prairie du Sac. It's two different
Sauk
towns.
City, S-O-C-K?
S-A-U-K. City.
Sauk City and what's
Prairie
the other
one? Du Sac.
Prairie du Sac.
D-U and then capital S-A-C.
Wow, those are wild names.
It's
Sauk City and Prairie du Sac.
Yep.
Now, there are people out there going, where the heck are those places? When is this thing and how do we get there?
Well, we're halfway between Madison and Wisconsin Dells, so it's easy to find.
I know those two places.
Yep.
Sure. Yeah.
And we're right along the Wisconsin River.
Mm-hmm.
The event is Friday night and all day Saturday.
Now, you throw the cow chips. Do people have to catch them?
No.
No. To me, that would be funny. You're throwing the feces of a bovine. And it flies through the air and then you catch it.
It's actually pretty dry. So
it's dry.
Yes.
Well, it would break and everything. That would be funny too, because it's poo poo. You know what I mean? It would be like naughty.
Well, if you'd like to come out and get the fresh pies when we go out and collect them, you're welcome to do that.
You don't go get fresh pies.
We do. We take.
Wait a minute. Your job as a committee member, a cow chip committee member, is going to get the fresh pies in the field before they dry.
Yep. We'd fill up a whole wagon full.
Now, Marietta, how'd you get that job? Yeah, how'd you get that?
Well, I'm a farm girl, so I'm not afraid of those kinds of things.
Now, do you have a special flat shovel that you pick the fresh cow poo-poo pies up with?
Well, you can use a flat shovel, or actually what works better is a pitchfork.
Now, wait a minute. When you say a pitchfork, it's not completely dry, but it's getting there because... you put the pitchfork under it. I got you. Sure.
And then you flip it over onto your hand.
No, you do not.
Yeah, because the bottom is really, really soggy, typically, when we pick them up. And then you flip it over.
And you wear gloves. You wear gloves?
Well, you can if you want, but I don't.
Wait a minute. So you go out there with a pitchfork and your bare hands, and you flip a fresh cow pie into those lovely soft hands of yours.
Exactly. Because, see, the top is a little crusty, but the bottom is very mushy. So we flip it upside down, stick it on the wagon, and let it dry.
Are you married or single?
I'm actually married, and I have three daughters, and I make them go pick up chips over the
years. Oh, stop. Wait a minute. Christina, has anybody ever asked you?
Nope.
No. Would you ever go with your mother and pick up a crispy on the top, soft on the bottom cow chip?
Not with my bare hands.
Yeah, the bare hands. Now, aren't there worms and stuff that can dig into your palm and suck your blood out or kill you or something? There's so many nasty things out there.
I suppose if you let the maggots sit on your hand long enough, but, we really don't do that.
There are maggots in the pies.
Once in a while, yes.
Now, your daughters are all single?
Yes.
Okay, just checking.
13, 18, and 21.
Well, that's why, because they're too young.
Now, the older ones, I can't get them to do it anymore, but the 13-year-old will still go do it.
Loves doing it. Okay. Well, you know what? I would like to do it just maybe one time. How long have you been doing it?
This is my 22nd cow chip throw.
Now, the cows are out there pooping. You pick them up.
It's not cows. It's actually beef cattle.
It's beef cattle. What's the difference?
Well, if you go into a barn, like a milking parlor, and mm-hmm. actually looked at the chips that they have, mm-hmm. they're very flat as a pancake because
right.
they're fed a lot of grain, so mm-hmm. there's not the fiber. So basically what we want is the cow, or what we actually go and get beef cattle because it's a high-fiber diet. So it makes a thicker chip, and it will fly better.
Well, I'm looking at the names that you, every year you have a name for the Wisconsin State Cow Chip Throw, which is this weekend coming up,
yes.
by the way, right?
Yes.
Marion Park at Prairie du Sac, Wisconsin, Grand Avenue and First Street. So in 1989, it was Chips Happen, right?
Yes.
A fling and a flare, the mother of all throws, where eagles soar and cow chips fly, come fly the friendly pies. That one I like. Where chips hit the fans.
And that actually happens. Where?
Well, wait a minute. I thought you said people don't catch them.
Well, with their face once in a while, they get hit. Because
you mean a guy flings it or a woman flings a pie and it goes, like a golf tournament, it goes astray into the crowd?
Exactly. Mm-hmm. It's really the like a baseball diamond, but instead of going from first to third, it'd be kind of like from first to second. You know, from the pitcher's mound, kind of at mm-hmm. a narrower angle. And on each side of that, we have bleachers. So people are supposed to be watching as the throw is happening. But once in a while, people get hit. And actually, one time, a woman got hit twice. It's like, come on, pay attention.
In the head, twice in the head.
Twice in the head, yep.
In 2005, it was called the Poop, Scoop, and Boogie. What's this year's title of the cow chip throw?
Love, Peace, and Chips.
Love, Peace, and Chips. And, of course, and it's all about, it's almost like a big Trojan cow I see here. When did they have the big Trojan cow?
The Trojan cow is actually what we have it on our grounds, but we take it into our parade and other parades in the area. Mm-hmm. And it actually does poop out the manure.
You mean the cow that you've made?
Yes.
It's a fake cow. What kind of poop comes out of that cow?
Dry. And then we have a group of people that actually play with it and shovel it around and actually give the chips mm-hmm. to the people in the parade route if they'd like to keep them.
No, wait. So you put a bunch of cow manure inside of a giant fake cow, and then the fake cow poo-poos out real cattle poo-poo.
Exactly.
And then people mold it with their hands.
Well, no, it's just a dried cow chip that comes out.
All right, just comes out of there. Now, has Brett Favre ever shown up and tried to win this thing?
No. You know, we had wanted to for years, but then with that whole, you know, Minnesota... Wisconsin mm-hmm. thing. You
oh,
know,
that's
we're not
right.
Really interested anymore.
No, but I mean, you're not interested anymore. But when he was a Green Bay Packer, you know.
Then we would have loved to have had him come.
But he never came out.
No.
You know, when I see something like the cow chip, you know, toss, you know, the Wisconsin cow chip, does it make you wonder why people make fun of Wisconsin sometimes?
Well, yeah, but you know, we're just good wholesome people, and we have a blast.
Okay, now, what? How far do you throw a cow chip? 8-10 feet? How far?
Well. Greg Neumeier's record's been standing since the 90s, and it was 248 feet.
No.
Yeah. We had a good east wind that day, and it just flew.
But how do you throw it like a frisbee?
Well, some people do.
How does he throw it?
More typically, it's a little bit more sidearm over the head. You know, like you'd throw a baseball, but not maybe... You know, not like a girl would throw a baseball, but like a guy would, a little bit more sidearm.
Now, so you have the flat thing in your hand, and you kind of, it's like an underarm pitch kind of a thing, right?
No, overhand.
Overhand.
Okay.
And it flies 248 feet.
Only that, once.
Yeah, right, because it breaks after that, right?
No, most people can't throw it that far.
No, that's unbelievable.
Yeah. The women's record, I think, is 171 feet.
Well, that's almost, you know, a football field is 300 feet,
yeah.
You know.
It's a long way to chuck a chip.
And is he a big fella?
No, he's not. But he's
now, what about a woman? What's the furthest a woman's thrown it?
171 feet.
That's a long way, too.
Yeah. But
wow.
Typically, To get into the finals, if a woman can throw 100, she gets in, you know, will be in the finals.
Who's the gal's name that's a big champion there? We already said Greg Neumeier.
Yeah.
What's a woman's name that's been the champion?
Terry Walshlager.
Terry Walshlager's been the champion?
Yes.
Now, is she a thin woman, a large woman? I mean, what do you need? Is it wrist movement? Is it body weight? What is it?
You know, she is really not that big. Mm-hmm. She's probably 5'6", probably weighs maybe 130 pounds. She's not a big woman.
Good. How far can you throw a chip?
I have made it into the finals before, but I've only thrown a few different years, maybe 100 feet.
And how many folks will be in attendance this weekend at the Wisconsin State Cow Chip Championship?
We usually have about 40,000 to 50,000 people come, and that's pretty good for a community of about 15,000.
That's unbelievable.
Yeah.
Well, Marietta Ryder, thank you very much, and Kevin Brushaber. You know Kevin Brushaber by any chance?
No, I've never heard of him, but I'll have to thank him.
Do you know the Brushabers of Wisconsin?
No, I'm sorry, I don't.
Okay.
I'll have to look him up and thank him for the referral. Okay.
Now, WisconsinCowChip.com, this weekend, the Wisconsin State Cow Chip Throw. And we had a member of the committee, been there for 20-something years, the lovely and exciting Marietta Ryder. Thank you so much, Marietta.
Thank you. And let me know when you want to come next July.
Oh, absolutely. Yes.
All
I need is a, you know, plane fare and a Motel 6, and I'll be the Grand Marshal.
All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Holiday Road for your summer. From Jay Thomas. Stars 2.
22 years, the woman goes out with a pitchfork and her bare hands with maggots and cow crap. Now that is a civic leader right there.
It's the fuel of our forefathers.
Well, I don't know. I said, you ever wonder why people make fun of Wisconsin? Now you know. Jesus. But by the way, 248 yards, feet is a long way. That's a long... It makes me want to try it. You know that, don't you?
Yeah.
I love throwing stuff. You know, people go, well, how did you get to throw the football on the Letterman show every year? You know, I always have had a good arm and played a little bit of, you know, small college football and arena and World Football League and all that kind of stuff. But when I was in high school, nothing but All-Americans played quarterback. And I had a big mouth. They wouldn't let... You know, the big mouth play quarterback. So I played all the other horrible positions, right? Remember the night the big quarterback came to the comedy, to Caroline's? Remember that, Garrett?
Oh, that was a quarterback?
Oh, God, yeah. And he played at Tulane and everything else. Oh, yeah, he was famous. Mm-hmm. And a baseball player. I think he played with the White Sox and everything else. Yeah. But when I was really little, like 8 or 9, gangs of kids would come into our neighborhood on their bikes. And they would... I don't know what exactly they would do, but they would put cards with clothespins on the spokes. So when they were coming, you could hear, like, did you ever hear that?
Yeah.
They were like, they would kind of scare you, right? And they would come and they would mess up your neighborhood. It wasn't vicious, but it was kind of scary. So they would drive in and we would, you know, we had tents and we had forts and all that stuff. And they would knock all of our shit down, right? And kind of terrorize the neighborhood. And then they would go back to their neighborhood, wherever they were from. Well, my brother and a bunch of guys would throw rocks at them when they came into our territory, right? And they would never hit them, you know? Well, when they realized how well I could throw a rock, I would win money. You would pick a spot on a tree or something, and we'd all get various rocks and try and hit like a little tiny branch or a leaf or something. I won all kind of money as a kid doing that, right? I wouldn't try and hit the guys. I would throw the rocks into the spokes, and I'd make the bikes crash. Yeah. I would hit the lead bike spokes. Oh. He would wobble, and the other guys would crash into him. So you'd hear, like that. Yeah. Oh, I love throwing stuff. I love it. When I'm in a grocery store sometimes, if there's a trash can like a like over people's heads and stuff, you know, and I'll have like some paper in my hand, I will flip it over. Of course, you know, it's rude, right?
Uh-huh.
But when it goes in the and sometimes not in the big garbage can, sometimes one of the a little small one, it goes in. People go, hey, good shot.
What do
people?
You,
yeah.
What do you think about guys that, you know, go to shoot their piece of paper in the waste bin, and like completely miss from 5 feet away? I kind of lose respect for people like that.
The ones I hate are the ones that miss and don't pick up the paper. Not only are they spastics, they're litterers.
Or you ever go and have like a catch with somebody and you realize they've never thrown anything in their life?
I have had guys tell me that they were a quarterback in high school or whatever. I mean, I've seen, it's unbelievable. And so, of course, me, you know, I'm an actor, I'm not tall. And if someone says, you know, Jay played football. Oh, really? Really? Like that? Oh, really? And you know, but you know, I weigh almost 200 pounds. That's what people don't get. You know, I mean, I played, let's say, I was like 185 when I played. So 5'8", 185 hitting you, it, you know, I can, you know, pack a punch, right? I mean, defense, I saw a guy the other night, a running back, 5'6", 205, right? My wife goes, oh, that's like you. I said, yeah, and he has a little dinklage in there. You had to be listening to the show earlier today to get that joke. You had to be listening from the beginning. You didn't get that joke, okay? And you know else? You know what else, Christine? It was a Peter Dinklage, wasn't it?
Yeah.
You said it. You don't remember the joke?
I remember the Dinklage part. I don't remember his first. I get it.
Get it? Your penis? Peter Dinklage?
Penis. Got it.
All right. Jesus Christ. So the guy, you'll throw the ball, and you're absolutely correct. You'll go, guy couldn't have played anything. Nothing. We went to a golf tournament with Gary Busey, and he told everybody he was a scratch golfer. Now, this is the truth. And he got on to the first tee, and he had brand new clubs and an outfit, and he couldn't hit the ball 3 feet. I mean, he couldn't hit it at all. He kept going, I don't understand it. Like that. He, like, never played golf in his life. I mean, it's just odd. Crazy. Oh, yeah. Here's another one. How come you throw the ball so hard? That's another one. And I'm not trying to throw it hard. You know, I'm really not. Oh, you want me to throw it hard? Now, here's the worst part. I taught one of my kids how to throw. I can't catch his passes now. That's the worst part.
Because he scares it too hard?
Jesus Christ, like a friggin' rocket. Now, we have no idea where it's going to go. But when he was a pitcher in Little League, he would throw about 4 or 5 steamers. So I would get out there with the catcher's mitt. He would always throw the ball. It would bounce right in front of the plate and hit me right in the balls. Every time I took him out to do it. And I wasn't going to put a cup on and a mask and all that, right? So I'd go, come on, let's go do it. Oh! And he was about 8. He'd go, what's the matter? What's the matter? I go, you hit me in the goddamn balls. That's what's the matter. And he would go like this. Oh, does that hurt? What does it look like? Then I'd get back up there. He'd throw another couple of steamers in there, right? Then sure enough, he'd bounce one in front and right into my groin, you know? One time I was coaching his little league team. Bases are loaded. He doesn't like, none of my kids don't like pressure, right? So I'm one of these. I go to the coach, I go, put the Beavis in, okay? Let him pitch these last two guys, okay? Bases loaded. We're winning the game. I go, okay, get in there and just throw some steam. As he's walking in, he goes, no pressure, huh, Dad? No pressure, huh, Dad? He walked in the tying run, and then he walked in the winning run. He would, but he'd get a great count on him. He'd have him 3-2, you know? Uh-huh. and then bomb. All right, you know. Oh, yeah. He'd have them swinging, you know. Ah, three, two, you know. Bomb. Bomb. I said this earlier, and I'm going to say it again. Lindsay Lohan's father has announced that he is opening a rehab center. It sounds like a joke, but this guy has announced that, and I hope he's not doing something with his wife, because Michael Lohan is moving to California to open a drug and alcohol rehab center. He said, I think it's time that Dina and I both step out of the media for a while. And for me, that means to getting back to what I know best, helping people with addiction. Now, am I wrong? Did he not do time as a drug dealer? Is that correct? Would you look and see, did he do real jail time?
I believe.
I think he did.
I remember seeing his mugshot for sure.
But I think he went away. Am I wrong about that? I think he might have gone away. Now, if you do exactly the opposite of what you did to Lindsay, everything will work out perfectly at your drug rehab place, okay? I mean, your daughter is hopeless. She can't stop. And you've also taken, apparently, a beautiful girl and turned her away from penis, okay? So you've caused her to want to drink, do drugs, act like an idiot, and lick other girls. Congratulations. Father of the fucking year. Do they not know what idiots they are?
How? Don't you have to have some sort of money to start to fund something like that? How is he going to do that with his daughter's money? I mean, he's not working.
I don't know. Did he do time?
Yeah.
Did he have?
Yeah, we're looking. I'm looking.
How much time?
He was released March 13th, 2007.
That's recent history. So it's not like 20 years ago he was a bad boy and he got straightened out, you know.
He was sentenced to prison for getting into a serious accident while under the influence. Mm-hmm. Spent the last 2 years at the Collins Correctional Center near Buffalo.
Wow.
Michael Lohan, who became a minister while in prison.
Of course he did.
Plans to go to the ministry soon after his release.
Mm-hmm. Tom Cruise crashed a teenage fan's dirt bike after reenacting a stunt scene from one of his action movies. After watching a youngster drive around outside the Scientology Celebrity Center in Hollywood, Cruise got on the dirt bike, and the teenager shouted to Tom, "Hey, show me some of your cool moves like you did in Night and Day." Trust me. The guy in Night and Day's name might have been Tom, but it was not Cruise. It was Tom Smith or Tommy Crash Bottom or whatever. After showing off a few wheelies, the 50-year-old star lost his balance, fell off, and damaged the bike. He told the kid, "Give me your name and number. I'll have it fixed as soon as you become a Scientologist." The teen said, "I would rather keep the bike in its smashed state and brag to people who damaged it." Jesus, that is unbelievable. So,
did he really say the part about the Scientologists?
No, he did not. I added that. See, I'm a humorist. I don't know if you know it or not, but every now and again there's a joke or two here. Mexican authorities have captured a blonde-haired, blue-eyed Texan. Now listen to this one. He's one of the biggest drug dealers in Mexico. He's an American citizen. He's from Texas. He's gone over with every gun that he has is from the state of Arizona or Texas. Do you know they don't make guns in Mexico? There's no gun manufacturing. They also, I don't think they even, you don't allow guns there. You can't buy one, nothing. there are lots of guns there and lots of people killing each other. They come from Arizona and Texas. So you stupid assholes have caused the problems that you're now having. Congratulations. Nice going. You don't hear people getting guns from Canada and coming down and killing everybody, you know. You don't see people in Washington State sending all their guns to Canada. No. So guess why you're having trouble? Because you can't get enough guns into Mexico. And it's a huge business. It's a $100 million business, right? So this guy, Le Barbie is his name. La Barbie. He is accused of being one of the hemisphere's most notorious drug cartel leaders. He is a United States citizen. La Barbie. You know who made the arrest?
I know.
La Ken.
Of course.
You know what, Garrett? It'd be a lot better if you just said
that. Was so telegraphed.
Really? Really? My uncle worked for the Telegraph. That's why I'm like that. Spanish police say that for the first time, they have broken up a human trafficking gang. Now, this is the real Spain. This isn't the Mexico. First of all, you know, the Mexicans didn't even want to speak Spanish. They were Aztec and Mayan and all that. It was the Spanish that made them speak Spanish. See? They would have just stayed, you know, Central American, you know, Indians, right? Now, the Spanish, they speak real Spanish. The police say they've broken up this human trafficking gang. They would bring men to the country to work as male prostitutes, load them up with Viagra, cocaine, and all of these stimulating drugs, and the guys' penises would stay hard 24 hours a day. Authorities arrested 14 people, mostly Brazilians, on suspicion of running this gang of hard-ons. Can you imagine? They would sit around a room with these big hard-ons.
Doing what?
I guess men and women would go in there and sit on their penises, I guess. It's a billion-dollar business. Brothels are staffed by immigrant women from Latin America, Africa, and Eastern Europe. They line the highways everywhere you go. Oh, we got to go to Spain.
I'm there.
Once again, immigrants doing the work that lazy Spaniards won't do. There you go. But can you imagine they load your ass up and you just sit there with a big heart on all day? Somebody's got to do it. On Monday's Rick's List on CNN, host Rick Sanchez was using a colloquial term for our president, Barack Obama. Let's listen to Rick Sanchez.
Going to change. There's a certain amount of the American public that's going to believe. Go ahead.
I'm just sitting here just shaking my head. He is the cotton picking president of the United States. Right. If the president of the United...
Now, he had to apologize for calling our half-white, half-black president the cotton picking president. First of all, that is an old term, isn't it? Kind of. When's the last time you said, you know, doggone it, he's the cotton picking pitcher of this team, isn't he?
Yeah, not for
who.
I know what
that?
It means, though.
Well, it doesn't
it's
mean
not that
anything.
Old.
It just means gosh darn. He's the darn president, or he's the gall dang. Is Rick Sanchez a Southerner? Where's he from?
I will look it up.
The next time I go on CNN, I'm gonna go, hey, is Rick Sanchez the lettuce picking reporter around here? You know, now that's an insult. Now, yes, he says he grew up in the South and cotton picking is something that's always said to illustrate frustration. Do you have, who would say cotton picking? Somebody in the cartoons would say it, wouldn't they?
There was no, that was Cotton Eye Joe.
Rootin' tootin', they would say rootin' tootin'.
Sanchez was born in Cuba and grew up in Hialeah, Florida.
Oh, right. They say cotton picking in Hialeah all the time. That's not the South.
His real.
You go down to Miami. Trust me, there are more Goldbergs down there and Sanchez's than they are, you know, Southern, you know, Spears and all that kind of stuff, right?
His official name is Ricardo Leon Sanchez de Reynaldo.
Cotton picking. 12 people in Statesville, North Carolina. You might be able to find this on WBT. See if there's a WBT, which is the TV station out of Charlotte, that might have a live report on the 12 people that went to hunt for the ghost train. You know, one of the shows, by the way, I don't even know if it's going to come back on the air because the Travel Channel's been sold. The guy that is the president, first day at the first meeting, goes, I don't like ghosts. First day. First thing out of his mouth. So the people go to look for the ghost train, 12 of them. They go at 3 o'clock in the morning up to a trestle, which is kind of like an aqueduct-looking thing, right? And the trains run over it. Oh, God. Oh, yeah.
I just found the article. I don't have the video or anything.
You don't have it? I really mean this. I think that on my ghost story show that's running on, or supposed to run in the fall on Travel Channel, but may go someplace else, I think we did the story about this ghost train where the guys that built it had died and the train and blah, blah, blah. So they went to look for the ghost train. You will never guess what happened. A real train came and killed a couple of them. Okay, you see, I'm gonna get the email. How dare you with the death? Look, it's 3 o'clock in the morning. You go with 12 friends, and you get on a bridge, and you don't check the schedule of the trains that are coming, and you have nowhere to go. You're on a train track. Where when the train comes, you can't even stand against, you know, a wall.
Oh,
there's
like,
nothing.
Like Stand By Me?
Yes. And then they poke the dead body with a stick for a while. During the investigation, witnesses told deputies they were at the site in hopes of seeing a ghost train. The sheriff said, believe it or not, this incident coincided with the anniversary of the train wreck that happened in 1891. Isn't that unbelievable? They were amateur ghost hunters. I think the word amateur here is the main one. All of the victims were able to jump off the trestle or hide or do something except for one guy. Let's... Christopher Kaiser, 29. You know the last sound he made? Splat. An idiot. Watch this. Jay, wake up. Huh? What? Hey, we're going to go to the trestle. Look for the ghost train. Really? You know what? I'll have some hot coffee for you and some pancakes when you get back. Okay. I'm not going to go. I am not going to go. Ron Paul, he's a Republican of Texas, and his son is running for something or other out of Kentucky. And a lot of people like Ron Paul and the Tea Parties and all. He doesn't believe there's any gold in Fort Knox. Have you read this?
Yeah, a lot of people don't.
What do you mean a lot of people don't? I never heard that.
A lot of people, they had a whole opening, I want to say in the 80s maybe, because there was a fear that they were just, you know, saying that because what's the difference? It's stupid metal that has no relevance to money anyway. So they just make it up and say they have whatever they have inside.
Well, he wants the Federal Reserve to audit the gold. He says if there's no question about the gold being there, you think they'd be anxious to prove the gold is there. They say they don't want to show you the gold for fear people will try and break into Fort Knox. Wow.
But I saw a video, and they did open it up, and there were a few reporters let in, and
they
saw the all the bricks sitting there.
Yeah, but wait a minute. Now, they could have painted them gold. You've seen the movies. Then you have to get a knife and dig into the paint a little bit, right? Let's go to Melanie on line two. Melanie, what can you tell us about the ghost train story? Do you have anything to add, Melanie?
Well, yes, I do, Jay. And I just want to say that I've missed you horribly, and I just think you're just the best.
Where have you been that you've missed me? Did they put you in some sort of a rehabilitation center?
Well, no, not really. But I don't want to get into anything negative, Jay. I just want to end this on a positive note.
Were you put away because you were carrying somebody's child inside of you, and you had to go away to one of those places so you would for the unwed mothers?
No, I wasn't. I was kind of like hiding in kind of disguise.
You were hiding in disguise.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I was.
Why didn't you invite me to come visit you?
Well, I have. You can come out here and visit me in Calgary. And do you remember, Jay, that I'm the one that says that Jennifer Aniston is the double bagger?
She's the double bagger? Because why? Why? I don't remember that.
Because she's so freaking ugly. You need to have a double bag in case her bag falls off while you're...
You think Jennifer Aniston is ugly? I think she's adorable.
No. I don't think so. And I was talking to you previously about that, and I don't understand, you know, what the appeal is.
She's got a cute face. I mean, a gorgeous body, of course, but she has a cute face. But I do think that she has some... bodily odors. She's got something because, listen, there's a woman that married a bunch of prisoners. Did you tell me about her, Christina? She'd married like 10 or 12 different guys. She gets these army guys, not prisoners, army guys fall in love with her. And they showed a picture of her in the paper, and the army guys looked totally normal. She was just awful looking, and guys couldn't wait to marry her, right? And she was taking their money and all. Now, Jennifer Aniston, nobody wants to marry her, and that's not a joke. Nobody wants to marry her. Nobody.
They don't even want to date her. I think she's a dyke.
That's your theory.
That's my theory, yeah.
I do not think for one, I mean that. I do not think for one, that's too easy of an answer.
No, I think that Brad Pitt was a beard.
So what do you think of Angelina Jolie, then?
Same thing.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Think about it, Jay. So anyway, I'm getting back to the train splatting story, right?
Yeah, sure.
Well, yesterday you were pondering what that fellow that called you a liberal winebag, maybe his name was Chris, he sent you an email.
I don't remember, but I remember liberal winebag. I do remember that
one, yeah. Well, he said that he was writing you off because you're totally insensitive and you make fun of some dead person.
A lot of dead people, yeah. And then today, of course, the train thing, yeah. But I find it funny, yeah.
I don't mind at all. But I thought, you know, when you were looking for examples, you were saying to your staff, who did I make fun of? Well, you just made fun of a dead person today, Jay.
Yeah, but he was looking for a ghost train, and guess what?
What?
He found it. He was looking. He was, wasn't he? They go there looking for the ghost. And you know what? I work for the company that produces Ghost Adventurers.
Yes.
And we've had those guys on this show. But I'm sorry. That is lint. I don't know what they're seeing as ghosts. And those voices they're hearing, all that shit. I'm telling you right now, that show would only be a hit to me is if one of them dies every week or something grabs a hold of. I mean, come on. No one ever dies. The ghost never does anything to any of them. Total bullshit. On my ghost story show, we found people in one of these houses where the ghost grabbed the guy's hand with the knife and stabbed him in the hand.
Oh, my God.
And the daughters were in the room, and there were witnesses and all that stuff. Yeah, these ghost people that go looking for it, this guy went looking for the ghost train. Well, he's on the ghost train now. So from now on, Christopher Kaiser, people are going to be looking for Christopher Kaiser. He's no longer, by the way, an amateur ghost hunter.
Isn't that ironic?
He is a fucking professional. He's, by the way, he got his wish. He got his wish. And I'm going to say this to his spirit right now.
Okay.
Christopher Kaiser of Statesville, North Carolina, I'm a huge fan of yours. You went looking for a ghost, and you succeeded.
That's awesome.
Unfortunately, that ghost is you. All right? Melanie, I'm glad you're back. Stay where you are. I'll be right back.
All right.
We got some sort of a sex maniac coming on after us today, Garrett.
That is correct. Emily.
Sex with Emily. Well, it's not until 8 o'clock, right?
Yes.
Emily is the new Stars 2 sex tutor. Well, if you need help, you're doing it wrong, I guess. I don't know. She's a hot chick, and she wants to talk to you about your sex. I'm going to call her later. Watch this.
Emily? Yeah. How do I get this dick out of my mouth?
By the way, Emily, I don't know if you're listening to us now or whatever. I don't know what shows you've been on before, what channels you've been on. Prepare yourself. Okay? Prepare yourself. A little while ago, we had a nice lady on. About funerals, and a guy called up and said, I want to bury my tongue in your ass, okay? Just, you know, just to give you a little heads up. Let's go to, we have this story here. Paris Hilton has been charged with cocaine possession in Las Vegas. The police are not going to drop the charges. She was with her mogul boyfriend, Cy Waits. They were in their Cadillac Escalade. Guilty.
Guilty.
Pulled over. By the way, someone said, what do you think made him pull it over? Someone said, that's Paris Hilton's limo. And the cop went, oh, really? Pulled it over. Hilton and Waits were pulled over because the cop said he could smell the pot. What was it, coming out of the windows? On the strip? How do you smell pot on the strip?
It must have been parked. Were they parked?
Or maybe, no, they pulled like, him they over. Smoking and blew the smoke out and behind them was a cop. I don't know.
Hilton said, please take me inside the Wynn Hotel to avoid cameras. A large crowd gathered around the limousine. In that moment, she decided to put her lip gloss on, and that's when the bindle of cocaine came out. Now, the term bindle, I've only heard it used among drug dealers. Do you know what a bindle is?
Never heard of it.
You know when they fold up the coke in the edge of the magazine? The little piece of paper that holds the coke in it?
Sure.
You know what I'm talking about, don't you?
No.
All right, watch this. Coke can come in the little glass container, right?
Yes.
There's a YouTube video of this.
Or you can fold it into a piece of paper or a magazine, and it folds flat, and then you open it up, and the coke is in it.
We're watching a YouTube video on how to make
That's called a bindle. It's called a bindle.
It's got a square piece of paper. It's in the diamond shape. He folds it in half, so it makes a triangle.
You've never been doing coke, and someone opened up a piece of paper, and you stuck the straw in
it. No, it's always been like a bag.
Oh, well, anyway, there's a bag. You can make a bindle kind of out of the bottom of a bag. I don't know how I know these things. But I, you know why? I dated a girl named Melanie Bindle.
Whoa, boy, that'd be a great name. Nifty.
Yeah, it is cool. So she goes to put on some lip gloss, and this bindle flies out of her purse and lands on the ground. The cop knows that it's a coke bindle. She said, oh, that's a piece of gum. He tells her to back up, and she stops in the middle of putting her lip balm on. Can you believe this? Because there were people around the car while she's being arrested, she's a billionaire. She doesn't need any of the money that she makes, and she makes millions and millions from her whatever the hell it is. I don't know what it is. Mm-hmm. From her vagina, I guess. I don't know what it is, right? And so she puts lip gloss on. And now, and a Zigzag rolling papers came out, $1,300 in cash. And you know the next thing, hey, Lindsay, you're it. Tag. Tag, honey. That's what they do. I really believe that Lindsay Lohan was getting arrested more than Paris Hilton. It's her turn now. Zach of New York. Yes, Zach. Oh, by the way, it wasn't her Coke because she borrowed the purse. Wow. Hmm. Hey, by the way, that's not my nose. I borrowed that nose, and that's the white shit around the inside of my nostril. All right. I must be the only fucking guy on the radio who comes on, and you kind of think, if somebody laid a line out, 9 out of 10 times I might actually partake. Is that bad? Go ahead, Zach.
Jay, thanks for taking my call, and thanks for bringing up this important story. You know, I've been a friend of Paris and a friend of the Hilton family for a long
time. No, you have not.
They just...
No, you have not.
I believe him, yes.
You have. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a close personal friend of Paris Hilton's on line 3. The Jay Thomas Show, where no one important ever calls. Thank Christ you've called, Zach. Zach, go ahead. Give us your one-on-one report. Go ahead.
I can't do it.
Quit. You know what? Listen. Hey, asshole, don't laugh until... We'll decide whether it's funny. Hey, asshole, we'll decide whether it's funny. So quit giggling at your own shit. Lay it out and let's see if it's any good. Go ahead.
I'm tilting. I can't. Anyway, the fact is the cops screwed up when they arrested her.
Really?
And yet, I mean, what she told them is correct. And she didn't actually, as being reported, she didn't borrow her friend's purse. Her friend gave her the little bindle. Thing is, she said, you know, there's a lot of cock in the spindle. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much. Zach of New York, a close personal friend of Paris Hilton's. That was actually good. Bill of Boston. Yes, Bill, how are you? Now, people go, who are those people that call you? There are writers. I have a staff of writers, and they're at a bank of telephones. Okay? You know what? Put Bill on hold. And we'll talk to him. I'm going to go in the other room right now, Garrett. I'm going to congratulate Zach, and I'll be right back. Pod. Garrett, Christina, join me. Ready? Ready? Now, are those phones lighting up for the sex lady?
Psychic lady,
you want to
talk?
Yeah, psychic.
The pet communicator. Mm-hmm. Oh, all right. It's only fun when Kevin Meaney is here. All right. Hey, Bill of Boston, we have less than a minute. Make it fast, Bill of Boston.
Hey, Jay.
How much time, Garrett?
40.
40 seconds. Hurry, Bill, fast.
That story you did about prostitution in Spain, many of those guys were tricked into prostitution. They thought they were going there for restaurant work and construction.
Really? What are they going to do, hang towels in those penises?
I guess so. So you may want to think twice about your next job offer.
What does that mean?
To be careful where you go to work next time.
Shut up, Bill. An idiot. Don't say shit I don't understand, please.